ABC Sports proudly presents exclusive coverage of the national championship game of the Bowl Championship Series.
In its existence, the Bowl Championship Series has never failed to deliver an undisputed national champion. But no season has been quite like this one, with USC already staking its claim to a share.
I think we just won a national championship.
And now, every team except two have been measured this bowl season. Oklahoma and LSU move center stage, determined to state their case for a championship. And throughout the season, the Oklahoma Sooners pillaged all comers. They scored more than 50 points in seven games, and they were favorably compared with the greatest of all time. But then came the Big 12 championship game. Kansas State exploded the myth. For an entire month, Heisman-winning quarterback Jason White has lived with this bitter taste.
That feeling is horrible. We don't want it happening again. It's do or die for us.
The LSU Tigers storm into New Orleans, riding a seven-game winning streak. The Tigers dominated Georgia in the SEC championship game with big plays and a smash-mouth defense. Coach Nick Saban built this powerhouse around speed and a relentless bump-and-run blitzkrieg.
We don't play DB like this. We don't play bump-and-run like this. Got to have balance and body control.
Every game played, every inch of turf battled for has led to this showdown between Oklahoma and LSU for the BCS National Championship. You are looking live at the Louisiana Superdome in New Orleans for the final college football game of the season. Oklahoma's great fans long ago exhausted their supply of 37,000 tickets. The LSU fans, now, they didn't have far to drive. Their campus in Baton Rouge, only 90 miles away. As we welcome you to the Nokia Sugar Bowl, the BCS National Championship game between Oklahoma and LSU. Well, good evening, everybody. I'm Brett Musburger. You know, when the season began, we all thought this game would be the end of the argument. Now we know it's just the beginning. USC has already claimed its share of the championship, and well they should, the way they played in the Rose Bowl. But make no mistake about this, Oklahoma and LSU earned the right to state their case here tonight. And when it is over, one of them will hoist the crystal football and declare that they too are national champions. So who's right? We'll let you decide. We're just happy to have you along with us for what we think is going to be a very fierce and intense Nokia Sugar Bowl. Job well done. And I welcome my partner, Gary Danielson. Gary, first of all, Happy New Year.
Same to you, Brent.
Now, the BCS Championship game, we were there when the trouble started.
Right.
Oklahoma lost big to Kansas State. Any lingering after effects here?
Well, we'll have to see, Brent. I mean, just imagine. I mean, these Oklahoma players aren't machines. They've been through a lot here. For most of the season, they were being compared to history. Now, if they win this football game, there's a team out west that doesn't even think they deserve half the championship. That's a lot to deal with. I thought in that football game, for the first time I've seen them in a couple years, they lost their swagger. And I don't care about X's and O's. I don't care about blitz packages or how you throw the ball. You can't win a big game like this against a great team like at LSU if you don't have your swagger. They must get that back to win.
Well, I remember what Gary said that night, that Bill Snyder and K-State had given the prescription for beating Oklahoma. Will Nick Saban follow that game plan?
I don't think he will. I'm surprised. I thought the blueprint was rush four, play a deep zone, and make everything happen in front of you. And LSU is capable of doing that. They got a very talented front four. But what got LSU here, and they got better all year, was doing what they do best. They got great corners. They pressure the quarterback. It's going to be an NFL-style attack the cornerback, and that's what Nick Saban believes he can win with. It's been getting better all year.
And of course, we're playing on an artificial surface. A fast field tonight. Let's go down in the middle of the field in the coin toss.
Oklahoma's a home team. LSU is a home team.
Oklahoma.
Yeah. Sure. Rudy. Well, what goal you want to defend? Okay.
This BCS championship game. Let's go down to Jackaroo.
Let's go! Well, Brett, you know Nick Saban leaves nothing to chance. In fact, he is a stickler for detail. So a couple of days ago, while cruising the internet, what did his staff find on the OU official website? But championship materials, hats, t-shirts, caps. So Nick Saban demanded that they download those offers, and he put them in his locker room. They're prominently posted in bulletin board material. Let's check in with the fourth member of our team tonight. Swan.
Thank you very much, Jack. As you point out, very often little things can make big occasions unbelievably fantastic. And what's going to happen here in special teams, I believe, is that Antonio Perkins for Oklahoma is going to be a catalyst for this football team. He's unbelievable. He's an All-American returning punt. He returned 3 in one game against UCLA. He's an All-American. But LSU has Skylar Green, number 5. He, too, is an All-American. He's returned 2 for touchdowns this year. He's averaging over about 20 yards per return. But Oklahoma's punt team has held all their opponents to 3.5 yards per return, Brent. Something's got to give you.
Exactly. Let us take a look at Bob Stoops, the fifth season in Norman, Oklahoma. 55-10. One national title and 2 Big 12 titles already. He's been to 5 bowls, and he is 3-1. Matching wits with one of the best, Nick Saban, in his fourth year at LSU. He's out of Fairmont, West Virginia, and he's one of the hottest names you hear with regard to perhaps moving on to the NFL. We'll develop that story as the evening proceeds. Now, Oklahoma won the coin toss, as you saw, and that means LSU will go on the attack for Trey DiCarlo. Put the ball on this new artificial surface. Skylar Green with all that speed and more speed. Devery Henderson into the end zone. Thought about it, takes a knee, and it'll come out on the 20-yard line. So here is Matt Mark, number 1 in the SEC in pass efficiency rating. And what an interesting story. 24 years old. You see his football numbers there. But, folks, this young man was in the Chicago Cubs organization for 3 years before deciding to come back to college. He has passed his exams to go to dental school. He has a choice to make. There will be 3 factors. Does he come back and play next year for Nick Saban? Does he take a shot at the NFL, or does he just move on to dental school? We'll develop that story. First down play, Vincent, the freshman, breaks free in the secondary. Foot race, he can go the distance. Straight trips him up. At the 19-yard line, Derek Straight trips up freshman sensation Justin Vincent, who has reeled off 3 straight 100-yard games for the Tigers and just electrified this crowd.
Oklahoma comes out and blitzes on the first play. Safety blitz, when you get through the first level of linebackers, you have no safety help. Oklahoma, remember, Brent Venables is calling the new defenses, takes their safety out of the middle and attacks, and they get burned.
After the long run, Joseph Addai checks in. So a 64-yard run to start the game. Addai behind the H-back tries to get to the corner, jumps over one defender, and is out of bounds at the 15-yard line. Now the Nokia starting lineup for this OU defense, stunned on the first play from scrimmage. That front, one of the best, featuring Tommy Harris. Teddy Lehman, the all-world linebacker, outrun when Vincent broke into the free. And there on the right is senior Derek Straight, number 2, who just tripped up Vincent as he was headed for the end zone. Lehman now on the Sooners trying to regroup.
Oklahoma's in with their nickel, 5 DBs.
First pass to Clayton, and he's just shy of the 10-yard line. Derek Straight, number 2. Straight, of course, won the Thorpe Award as the top defensive back in college football, but he was also voted the winner of the Nagurski as the best overall defensive player in the nation. And he showed you a bit of his stuff with that tackle of Eddie Vincent, who was headed for the end zone that time. Here comes third down, and Shelby checks into that defensive package. Yeah, Brandon Shelby, an extra defensive back here.
That's 6 of them on this field right now against 4 wide receivers for LSU.
back in the shotgun. Low snap, picks it up, fires, complete. Clayton's got it inside the five and battles his way inside the three. That is a first and goal, but hold on. There is a penalty flag thrown back the 21-yard line.
An unbelievable catch by Matt Mock. His baseball skills came through, as you see, roughing the passer after he let it go. This was like a knuckleball. He makes the stop, and he throws the guy out at second base. That's where those athletic skills come through. What a play. Catch it, grab it, refocus, and he gets hit with the elbow right in the face. That's a wonderful call. What a play by Matt Mock.
And he put the ball in the hands of one of the strongest wide receivers of the SEC, Michael Clayton, who just battled his way to the 2-yard line where it'll be first and goal. And the jumbo set will now come in as Clayton goes to the sideline.
I really think Oklahoma's corners lost their focus when they saw the ball drop on the ground.
Justin Vincent in behind two lead blockers. Mock goes down again. Bobbled the snap from Wilkerson.
I don't know if he got this one.
And it's turned over inside the 5-yard line. Oklahoma has the football. Derek Strait recovered it. First he saves the touchdown with the tackle. Then he recovers this fumble.
Bad center exchange. A quarterback in goal line offense must be very careful with the center. The center reach blocks, and a lot of times their butt turns a lot and you don't get the snap.
We'll take a break. Oklahoma has the ball inside the five. Timeout. Ben Wilkerson sitting there. That was his 872nd snap of the season, only 8 of them bad. After it occurred, both coach and quarterback went over to pick him up with encouragement. There were no harsh words exchanged after the bad center quarterback exchange. Gary, you had a reason for why it happened.
Yes, it was a reach block by the center, and that is really on the quarterback. He must really stay with the center and ride, especially in goal line, especially on first down. You just can't have that happen on first down.
Our first look at Jason White since he picked up the Heisman Trophy in New York. The toss play to Jones, who tries to get the corner against this fast defense, and Jack Hunt, the senior, comes up on him. So many of you know the story of Jason White. You read about him, you saw him, his very gracious acceptance speech, only the fourth Sooner to win the Heisman. He is a senior, but he can come back next year. He was granted an extra year of eligibility, and everyone around Soonerland expects that he will be back. Now, after Kewan Jones started the game, Ronaldo Works checks in. Jones was a situation starter simply because they were backed up and they wanted to see if he could get the corner like he did against Kansas State. He did not. Second down and from the end zone, White moving the pocket. Now comes far to double coverage, thrown, juggled, intercepted by Webster. Webster at the 40-yard line. Corey Webster. Still going down to the 31-yard line. One of the best defensive backs in college football. Picks it off, and now it is a turnover apiece. And as Gary Danielson predicted, this will be a fierce defensive war all the way.
Bump and run coverage. Oklahoma goes after the bump and run with a double cut. Watches out and up. But the great technique by Webster, and then this ball is just thrown for anybody to get it. Remember, Corey Webster, number 13, the All-American defensive back, was recruited as a wide receiver and actually played one whole year here at wide receiver. He's very comfortable with the football in the air.
He is a tall corner. Both of Nick Saban's corners are tall, and Bob Stoops and his staff have had to adjust. And breaking offside is Oklahoma, I believe, on this play.
Fumble the ball.
There's a fumble, however, and it goes to Oklahoma if they weren't offside. The linesman threw the flag. It was recovered by Dante Nicholson. There was no question, I thought, from up here that they were offside.
It was Cody right here. Yep, clearly, clearly. Came right across. Whitworth had no chance to block Cody, but then another fumble, ball on the ground. You can feel the bigness of this football game. Mistakes, self-inflicted wounds already. Jason White shouldn't have thrown the ball up. The double cut wasn't there. Should have thrown it away on second down. The fumbled snap, and now another one right here.
David Jones checks in with the play. Matt Knock has got the formation from the sideline. First and five after the offside penalty on Dan Cody. Vincent on a play fake. Knock stands at the 35. He was an excellent runner a couple years ago. On the move, throws in zone, incomplete. And he, too, fired into coverage down there, looking for Clayton. And Greenwood Henderson was behind him. So the Oklahoma Sooners and the LSU Tigers in the Nokia Sugar Bowl playing for the BCS National Championship tonight in New Orleans, Louisiana. And we figured it would be defense, and so far this game has featured a turnover apiece. But again, LSU with superb field position. And Vincent already with a 64-yard bolt for the offense. He's standing back at the 35-yard line on this second down and five after the incompletion. Let's see if they come back with the freshman. They do. Tries to cut to the left. Breaks the first tackle and crosses the 25-yard line. Everidge could not wrap him up, but Teddy Lehman does as we check in down below with Jack Aroo.
Well, Brent, when Nick Saban first got to LSU, Corey Webster wasn't even in the potential recruiting class. In fact, it was Nick who gathered the coaches, the new staff together, and said, I want to see all of the available players. I want a new list. When he got that list together, there's where Corey Webster's name appeared. It's a good thing that he asked for a recall.
All right, Jack, and Skylar Green has just checked in from LSU. He's out to the right. It's the three-pack. It's Clayton. It's Henderson. It's Green for Mauch. And he'll call a timeout after looking at that defense. The linebackers had dropped way back into a looked like a zone, and Mauch called timeout. Corey Webster, 14 career interceptions. He, too, will have a choice to make as to whether or not he decides to leave Baton Rouge early and go to the NFL or stick around for another season. Green in motion's got great speed, looking for the corner, got the first down, got it turned. Here he comes, the track man zips to the end zone for the game's first touchdown, 24 yards for Skylar Green.
Run the sweep. Watch this block by Joseph Addai right here, right on the outside. He gets the outside hip, outside leg. Michael Clayton downfield blocking the All-American wide receiver. He gets his block, and they sprint into the end zone. Big plays.
Ryan Godet will kick tonight. He makes the extra point. It's 7-0. Gary, let me ask you this. Could Oklahoma be shell-shocked by this early start? And again, they're giving up the big play like they did against K-State.
We've done them for two straight years. I've never seen them all year before Kansas State. The longest play they gave up was 42 yards. Now multiple big plays. That means players are trying to do too much. They're getting outside the defense.
Jones is the running back off to the quarterback's right. With three wideouts, Jason White goes down the sideline. Clayton juggles incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. And how quickly the safeties are reacting for LSU to double up on that side as we take a look now at the Nokia defensive lineup for LSU. Spears, Lavallee gets all the pub, but Marquise Hill, he played a little football too. And the linebackers, Eric Alexander, wants a safety, moves in there to give great speed at that real linebacker spot. Randall Gay, a senior, he's the nickelback. LaRon Landry, the leading tackler with this team. You've already met Mr. Corey Webster, who has an interception here tonight. Second down and 10 for Jason White, who seems to be flinging the ball in the air. He puts this one into Jones's hands. Jones battles his way to the 25-yard line. Gary, I'm not sure I recognize the throwing motion that the quarterback, Jason White, is using. He seems to be arching the ball more than we've seen.
Well, he has thrown against bump and run two fade passes. This is a little slip screen. Can't really measure much on this one.
No,
but he has taken a pounding in the last two games. He hurt his wrist, remember, against Kansas State. And we still wonder if that's 100%. But when you face bump and run, you have to throw the fades. And he's been lobbing a few of them so far.
Saban's two corners are right up there in a familiar coverage, just 3 yards off. Lavallee was battling his way in, and there's interference on this play. Webster had jumped Jones coming across, and that flag was thrown because of Corey Webster's aggressive defense. Now, Gary, give us a read as a former quarterback. What you look for now in a bump-and-run situation like this when you know you've got press coverage?
Early in the football game, you've got to be careful not to fall into the trap of throwing too many fades. They want you to throw fades. It's a low priority, low percentage completion. You must establish that slant pass, and I think Chuck Long did the right thing of saying, we must show you that we'll try to get that ball inside out.
Jack, let's follow up on that hand story. Could there still be a problem with the quarterback?
Well, Brent, they say, and Jason insists that it is not, but when he came home from the Heisman Trophy week in New York City, I went to shake his hand when I was in Norman, and he winced in pain. When I got here, likewise. I don't know, Gary, but it could be affecting his throw. It's still a little tender.
Runnels lines up in front of Works. He's a lead blocker, and he's a dandy. Works cuts back in that defensive front for the Tigers. Now, Gary, I want to take everybody back to Arrowhead Stadium that night on December 6th and take a look at this, because this is the play that you talked about when Jason White is abused.
It was the interception, big interception, and when they had it down there, it was a 14-7 game. He lands on it, and you see it right there. Those things linger. Look, you know, we just watched Brett Favre play. It had thumb has lingered all year.
What a great victory in overtime for the Packers on an interception. Second down, Randall Gay checks in as the nickel back. Jones comes through the motion for the Sooners. White back in that shotgun. The offensive line gives him time. He completes it in underneath. And the ball is to the 41-yard line before there was Marquise Hill at 6'7", 245. Very active defensive end from New Orleans jumped back on the play.
One of the things that LSU wants to do, and their defensive coordinator, Will Muschamp, wants to do, is take away the screen and draw game from Oklahoma. There's Will right there. He says they are great at screens and draws. We must force Jason White to throw the ball downfield, or we won't be able to sack him.
Third down and three, back in a passing formation with four wide for the Sooners. Spread the field, deflected, incomplete. It is fourth down. The Sooners are forced to punt.
Deflected balls. They had eight of them against Georgia. On the short passing game, they jumped. They're very tall at the defensive line position. That time it was Pittman, number 48, that got it.
Now, the number one return man in the nation. Remember, Perkins had all the touchdown runs, but Ferguson matched up with him, drives it deep. They're going to see what he's got. Over his head and on into the end zone. It'll come out on the 20-yard line. That was Bradley, Mark Bradley, racing downfield on coverage. One of the Sooner wide receivers. LSU up by seven. We've got a timeout. A fierce 6 minutes unfolds here on the Louisiana Superdome. 9 minutes to go in the opening quarter. Tigers 7, Sooners nothing. LSU football coming out from their own 20-yard line. Matt Mountain, who was unable to play in last year's Cotton Bowl because of a foot injury, is now very healthy for this game here tonight. Moves up under center. And on first down, they elect to put it in the air, and his receiver slipped. Henderson slipped.
He slipped right on the painted portion of the artificial turf right there. Well, let's talk about what I think is going to happen. Controlling the line of scrimmage. Both coaches said the offensive lines and defensive lines must come through for their team to win it so far. That LSU defensive line is controlling it. Nick Saban believes like the NFL believes. Third down is get the ball, keep the ball down. Let's see who wins that one. And defensive big plays. We've seen Derek Strait with one. We've seen the fumbled snap, and then we've seen the interception.
That was a third down touchdown. Third and two, 24 yards. So there was your big play right there.
Third down.
Second down and 10. Vincent battling for two or three. Let's check in with Lynn Swan. Lynn?
Brent, Michael Clayton will tell you that his assets are catching the ball, great hands, but combined with his physical ability, makes him an unstoppable combination. Here he catches the contested pass, keeps the drive alive and the team going, and he sacrifices his abilities by making blocks unselfishly to help his teammates move down the field. That's the kind of player you want on your team. That's how you win championships.
So, Gary, now on this third down, we've got Michael Clayton poised.
Yeah, and I think it'll be very conservative by Nick Saban. His defense is controlling the game. He will not let Matt Mock lose the ball game down here.
And Mock decides to use still another timeout. Remember, he knows how to manage the game, and something was not right for him, and so he will use his second timeout. I believe the clock was ticking down.
That's their second timeout.
Third down and long for LSU, and the man who is under the gun is right there, the new defensive coordinator. Remember, Mike Stoops has just been a consultant for this game. He's become the head coach at Arizona.
Let me fix this right here. Get that co right there, because Mike is now the coach at Arizona right there. He's got all alone now, baby. Nobody to share that 62-yard run against.
Now Malcolm Webster. Webster, the center. You can see him identifying the defense.
Three-man line for Oklahoma.
And they come on the blitz. Mauk stands tall, fires right side, incomplete. So the blitz helps force an incompletion. Skylar Green, the intended target, and Mauk picks himself up off the artificial turf.
Three-man line. They bring six players. You see it. Someone comes free. It's Brandon Shelby, number five. If you want a scout report on Brent Venables, Bose, and the difference between he and Mike Stoops, Venables likes the blitz more.
Now here it's Perkins' turn. Antonio Perkins, we saw him light up UCLA with three punt return touchdowns in one game back at Norman. Donnie Jones, one of the best punters in the country, matched against him. Oklahoma worked long and hard on trying to block a punt. They got a pretty good look that time. They may come up with something later. And Perkins catching the ball collides with, I believe it was his own man. It was pushed back into him, and they will spot the ball right there at the 36-yard line. Gary, let's take a look at our Dodge defensive playbook.
Well, get used to this. This is what you're going to see all night. You're going to see Webster and Daniels up man-to-man on the great receivers from Oklahoma. Double moves out and up. Will the discipline of the defensive backs and the LSU defense be able to handle the lob ball? Chuck Long believes that Jason White is one of the best deep ball throwers that he's ever seen. So far, though, he's been a little short on his deep throws.
First down, and they move White back center, indicating that maybe they're going to try to run the ball. They do. They bring Clayton around in, jumps over one would-be defender, and he's close to the 50-yard line, and he has moved the chains, and there is their run coordinator, Kevin Wilson. A little bit under the gun, too, because of the offensive line's performance. Over the last three games, they've allowed a lot more sacks than they did earlier in the year. Now, Kevin says you have to run on this front, and by far, Chad Lavallee, number 93, he believes is their best defensive lineman. First down now at 48-yard line after the 12-yard run. Still in that eye. They come back with Jones. And something's cooking here, Mr. Danielson.
Well, that's exactly what I believe Oklahoma had to do all year. Establish and take some of the pressure off their quarterback. When Jason White has an average game, they lose. When he has just a little bit of a good game, they can lose. He has to almost play great towards the end of the season for Oklahoma to win. And against these great defense, it's very tough for a quarterback to carry it without a running game.
And again, they are back in that power eye. And again, they run Jones, twisting, turning, got another first down on it. Now, here is the Tostitos player comparison. I mentioned Lavallee, Gary, and there's another pretty good defensive lineman in this game.
Tommy Harris, you know, everybody's looking whether he will go pro. Chad Lavallee will obviously turn pro. He's been here, 24 years old. Tommy Harris, they're saying, is a top five pick in the NFL, but he does not make a lot of tackles. If you watch him, he causes a lot of disruption, but he doesn't let a lot of tackles. This guy, Lavallee, makes a lot of plays.
It is interesting that the OU coaches had moved White up under center, and now they back him out. Back again in that shotgun with four receivers. That's a tight end, Donnelly. Over there is a look. He picks up the blitzer. Great read. White goes down near sideline. Jones jumps. And incomplete. I believe he was out of bounds. There's a young man who's a fine baseball player. He's been a starting outfielder for 2 years for the Sooners. The New York Yankees drafted him but couldn't sign him back in 2001. He makes a nice catch here.
Travis Daniels pushes the receiver to the sideline. Look at no room to throw the football, a perfectly thrown ball, and you're out of bounds. That's the technique. That's exactly what the defense is trying to do. And on that play, Brandon Jones got beat. Did not allow Jason White any room.
And that is the best throw of the night.
Absolutely.
For Jason White.
But he did serve notice. He's got that throw.
Second and 10. Back under center. Clayton coming in formation. Basically a slot man. Penalty flag is thrown prior to the snap, and this is going to cost Oklahoma. Now, Nick Saban, we have told you, blitz crew, bump and run. He allowed us to mic him at practice in Baton Rouge. I want you all to take a listen to Coach Saban.
All right, now come back. Outside in. We didn't strike. We didn't strike. Nobody's locking out. We didn't strike the guy. You got to strike him first. You get your hands inside on him. All right, now lock this arm out. And lock that arm out so you can steer him. See, when he got this arm down, then you're getting turned out.
He's a hands-on teacher. He's one of the best in the business. I can see why three or four NFL teams are interested, but he's very happy for the time being. White is back, sidearm incomplete. They had brought in Donta Hixon. They told me, Cale Gundy, the running back coach, had told me that Donta Hixon is going to see some action here tonight because of his speed. They are so cognizant of how much speed Saban has on the defensive side of the ball that the changeup is going to be number 35, Donta Hixon.
Now third and long is exactly where those defenses love to bring that zone blitz. They overload one side, and then they play a soft zone behind it.
Now, where will the pressure come from? You know it's coming from LSU. They're not going to rush four. There'll be five and maybe six. Here they come. White tries to find an open man. Incomplete, and the pressure was closing in from behind. And White, even though he wasn't sacked, he was down at midfield. He was knocked down on that play.
It was an all-out blitz, third and long, and it was man-to-man coverage. They're manned up all over the field right here, and here it comes. Here comes Jason. Throw a hot. We think we can make a tackle, a free safety in the middle of the field just in case somebody gets a play. And you see it. That's that pressure defense, why we all like to retire when we're in the NFL after a while.
Now Lehman calling the blocking assignments. Ferguson to punt it. Green is back deep with that speed. Signals fair catch at the 12-yard line. We check in down below with Jackaroo.
Well, Brent, before the season started, Nick Saban pulled out a DVD and played it for his team. It's the story of Seabiscuit. He explained to his players that Seabiscuit was an unheralded thoroughbred. And he said he was a horse that didn't get any respect and was a champion. He said, we're going to play this season exactly like Seabiscuit.
That was such an enjoyable family movie, Jack. Enjoyed every minute of it. I think I'll go out to the fairgrounds tomorrow and see if I can find me a Seabiscuit.
Hey, Brent, though, he's got some studs that aren't Seabiscuits on his team, though. He's got some thoroughbreds.
Secretariat, maybe?
Yes, he does.
Justin Vincent, the freshman. Out to the right. And slammed down at the 16. Gayron Allen, the linebacker, moves in. Folks, we are capacity plus. I've done a lot of football games here. Never seen a bigger crowd. We've had big plays. Corey Webster with the interception for the Tigers. And then Green on the wide end around. And the sprinter on the 4x100-meter NCAA champion relay team takes it to the end zone for the touchdown. And it'll be second down and long. Now, Gary, you make such a good point about Matt Mock. What's your feeling about what he must do here tonight?
Just manage the game early. Don't lose the game before you have to. Just stay, keep making first downs, hand the ball off, stay out of the bad place. When the LSU coaches, we asked them, why are you running the ball better the second half of the year? They said, well, number one, our freshman backs are better. But number two, Matt Mock has gained some experience, and he gets us out of those bad plays. We used to call him, the coaches used to say, well, just dial it again. You know, that one didn't work. Well, Matt Mock gets him out of those dial it again plays. He gets him into the right play.
He'll be married later this year. Has the play from the sideline. Center is Webster. Defensive line's made only one mistake here tonight. Third down and six for the Tigers, and Mock straight back.
Will.
Intercepted by Everidge. There is a penalty flag. Everidge at the 20-yard line, but the penalty flag was thrown behind the defensive backfield that time, and Clayton's picking himself up.
Yeah, he got
off the ground right now.
I thought Clayton got held on the play. Yes. The ball would have been incomplete anyway, but again, you know, in these big games, no matter how much you practice, there's an anxiety factor. Everything that looks good in practice, you panic during the game and you grab a guy.
Bob Stoops is not happy by that call.
Let's see if it was.
And you can see he is protesting vehemently on the sideline. I thought the flag came after the interception by Everidge. Let's listen to the Big East crew now.
against LSU. That is their first warning of the game.
Well, Bob Stoops is 4 years that's out on the field. And the warning's for Nick Saban. Go figure.
How about the important play?
Yeah, we're not too concerned about that sideline warning on the far side.
Now, I think
right
we don't know if it was holding on Michael Clayton. They obviously don't give the number. They don't give the penalty on this one. But the ball was thrown very high. I don't even know if it was catchable on top of that. And that's what Bob Stoops was upset with.
The holding call, not pass interference. That was a holding call. So that it moves the football out to the 27.
That's true.
That makes it a first down automatically. So now Everidge slipping up close to the line. Ali Broussard, another of the talented freshmen, checks in on the draw to the middle. And another freshman running back, number 22, bolts up the middle.
Well, let's see if we can spot something. Here's the game where the ball is going to go to the deep safety. Mock steps back, doesn't like to make these mistakes. A little pressure. I don't know. The holding was on the tight end
that
right there.
Shelby.
That's exactly right.
Shelby was holding the tight end.
Yep.
And that was a good call.
That was a good call right there. You got to watch them all, and somebody's watching the tight end with the back judge, and he got it.
Second and four for Mock and the Tigers. Ali Broussard's turn on the pitch. Wilkerson pulls. Nothing doing. Couldn't get that corner turn. Check is over there. And Derek Straight is playing a whale of a football game. Straight caught Benson on a breakaway on the first offensive play of the game. Recovered a fumble inside the 5 yard line. Now he makes the play on Broussard.
Well, let's see now if Nick Saban doesn't get into Jimbo Fisher, the offensive coordinator for LSU, and say, I don't want that ball thrown down the middle again. Let's run a quarterback draw or something safe and punt the ball. They haven't proved they can move it on us.
3:25 made into the opening quarter. 5 seconds left. 25-second clock. Mock gets the snap in the gun. Drops it off to Green on a flanker screen, and it was read beautifully by Allen.
Where both sides say good play. Nick Saban felt that his team was a little dangerous throwing out of his own end zone. Bob Stoops' defense, Brent Venables recovered from the holding call, and they get the ball back and into the dangerous hands of Perkins.
Johnny Jones.
Look at these wide splits, Brent. Look at the size of these splits here for LSU. Look at that space between these guys.
Oklahoma was working long and hard on blocking a punt all week long. Up over the top comes Bradley. Jones gets it off. Perkins, fumble! Battle for the loose ball. And Oklahoma recovered it. The official right on top of that play.
Boy, there was an early call there.
Well, wait a minute, LSU is signaling they're going to come up with that football, but the officials are hanging tough.
Perkins kind of gambles on this play, but you got to make plays. It was right in his stomach right there. Very tough arena to catch punts in. High ceiling, bright lights, and Perkins drops the first one.
Ball is at the center.
Jason White and the Sooners. LSU offense back on the field now. White has missed his last four passes. Be looking for something short. There's the H-back Ronalds. He's been a very active blocker. Lead man, Jones, slices to the 41-yard line.
Emerging story for Oklahoma on first down. Oklahoma and Chuck Long have run the ball five times and only thrown the ball twice. You can see they respect that pass rush and want to establish the running game.
And they are really giving Ronalds a workout. Now they have the three wide receivers bunched, and they bring Wilson through the formation. They've stacked basically over on the left side. White's going to roll the pocket over there into difficulty, throw it up for grabs, out of bounds. Incomplete. The pressure was coming that time from Marquise Hill.
He's a big one. He's the emergence of the two defensive ends. Hill and Spears have really brought this defense. Before it was just Lavallee inside. But this team, eight different players on this defense have three or more sacks. Imagine that. Eight different players on the team. That's how they come from all angles. You know, it's not just all blitz here. On second down, they're giving them a lot of zone also.
Chuck Long told me that J.D. Runnels was going to be the key to this game. He's got to pick up the blitzers. Third and long, he's back in. He's the bodyguard to the left. He's looking for pressure. He's got one. Gabe White time. Fired. First down at midfield. So J.D. Runnels doing some of the little things allows White to have enough time to hit Mark Clayton. What a fine block that was.
Sometimes when you blitz, you get a bad matchup. And that's what happened for LSU this time. And Jason White found it. You get Clayton on Jack Hunt. That's the safety right there. Jack Hunt cannot cover Mark Clayton. Watch him get turned around. Inside and outside, and there it is. An easy first down. Wonderful job by Jason White.
Illegal formation. This is going to cost them 5 yards. They'll bring it back. It'll be first down and 15. Now, we have only a minute 13 left in the opening quarter here, Gary. There's an emerging story. Oklahoma, the highest scoring team in the nation, has not scored in almost four quarters. Remember, they scored on their first series against Kansas State in Kansas City in the Big 12 championship game. They have not scored since then.
15 straight drives, 79 plays. It looked like one of my career highlights right there.
You were better than that.
Those are one of the ones where I put the backup. Start not work, talking to the coach for a long time after one of those.
First time he's ever been self-effacing.
Well, you know, they tried a trick play. Oklahoma did that time. A quick huddle, quick snap, but they did not line up properly.
So here's your first and 15 after the five-yard penalty. Runnels stays in a fullback position. They try to run behind him with Jones, and it was eaten alive that time by Travis Daniels. So the defensive back comes up and makes the play.
Corner blitz that time. They ran it right into the corner cat blitz. That is good coaching. You can tell this defense is inside the head of Oklahoma. There's Muschamp. Every time I saw him for the last, 3 weeks, he was watching tape, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. And he finally told us, he finally broke down, he said, look, if you rush four on Jason White, he'll complete 60% of his passes. If you rush five or six, it drops down to 43. So guess what he had in mind? Who counts all that stuff? Second down. White is back. Tries to drop it off, and Wilson juggling it on the dive was able to pull it in for a completion. But no, I think it's down. They'll be brought back down to the line of scrimmage. Minus 2 yards he lost on that play. So ABC Sports presentation of the Nokia Sugar Bowl will return with the second quarter after this message and a word from our ABC station.
And I think that's a good job by Oklahoma and Jason White, just taking what's there, not trying to force the ball downfield and playing a little field position game. Looks like Oklahoma's defense has settled down a bit, so Jason White can make a first down and just punt the football. It's not the worst thing that could happen.
Blake Ferguson standing back at the 35-yard line. Booms it toward Green. Green will let it bounce over his head. Bradley's right there. This will be downed inside the 5-yard line. You know, Gary, when you look back at the brief history of the Bowl Championship Series, You found kind of an interesting theory about the winning quarterbacks in this game.
I really do. I really think it's the type of guy that's like a coach on the football team. Craig Krenzel, Josh Heupel. You know, the guys that can make decisions on the field, Matt Mock, even Jason White. You want a guy out there that doesn't really throw the ball 70 yards, but gets you out of the bad plays. Those are the guys that are making plays.
Bad field position here for Nick Saban and the Tigers, and they must be careful. Protecting the football, Derek Strait in on the play defensively again. That knocked the veteran, the one-time minor league baseball player. He led Jasper High School to a state championship game before losing. He was Indiana's Mr. Baseball one year. That's what he elected to sign with the team that he always dreamed of playing for, the Chicago Cubs, but that didn't work out. He liked the team game a little bit better. He remembered that Nick Saban, a recruit in Michigan State, made the call, and here he is tossing now to Vincent. Vincent to the 3-yard line, and so it's quite a story here.
It really is, and when you put a quarterback together, you got to be a lot of different things, and Matt Mock is that. You mentioned a catcher. He's in charge of this football team, just like a great catcher on a baseball team. Very bright pre-med major. He uses that. It spills over into the football game, and he is great with his feet. He hurt that ankle last year, had a lot of spring football when he wasn't 100%, but remember, he burst onto the scene in 2001 with an injury to the quarterback, and he was a runner in that football game. He hasn't run yet tonight.
Back in the shotgun in that noisy end zone, directly in front of a whole lot of fans. And nothing doing for Adai as Brandon Shelby leads the Redshirts in on top of the LSU running back. And now, in a battle of field position, Oklahoma has an opportunity.
Yeah, blitz again, right into the blitz. Could not get the bowling guard that time. Tackle Rodney Reed to the point of attack quick enough. And for the first time in two games, Brent, I've seen that swagger start to come back to this Oklahoma defense.
Perkins is standing at midfield. Jones near the end line. Booms it. But this should be great field position. Perkins down at the 35-yard line. So the best opportunity of the game coming up now for Oklahoma. They're down a touchdown, but they're within striking distance. But they will be tested this time. Oklahoma at the 35-yard line. Let's see what they can come up with on first down. Nick Saban, like all outstanding defensive coaches, is a down and distance guy. He wants to win first and second down. He wants to keep them third and long. Ronaldo works. In is the running back. Remember now, White is under center. That has been a tip run so far here tonight. Play fake this time. White's in trouble, and he is sacked at the 44-yard line. That's why they put him in a shotgun when he throws the ball. Chuck Long saying he has more time to throw it. He couldn't pull out from center.
Yeah, Jason doesn't get back in the pocket. Well, he's not used to it. He hasn't practiced it. And this defense, Lionel Turner coming at it. Great speed, forcing the ball carrier back inside. The whole game plan has been attack the quarterback. And when he throws, get your hands up because he likes to throw short balls.
Will Muschamp, the defensive coordinator, as one of his players now is being tended to on the field. That's Melvin Oliver, the sophomore defensive lineman, shaken up. Jack, this is one of the best defenses we've seen this year, this LSU team.
Boy, Brent, they're very impressive. And maybe one of the reasons is because where they went and off to study, you know, all of these coaches, they like to exchange ideas in the offseason. Well, Mike Stoops, the former defensive coordinator for Oklahoma, visited LSU to study their defense in 2001. And then Oklahoma returned the favor for Will Muschamp as he went down to Oklahoma in Norman and studied the defense in 2002. Bet you they won't be doing that anytime soon.
Now, there is Mike Stoops, now the head football coach at the University of Arizona. He's been attending the practices, helping out a little bit, but basically staying pretty much out of the way. His brother had moved over to coach the secondary, and there you see Brent Venables discussing it with head coach Bob Stoops. Bob used to be a defensive backfield coach, so that was nothing new, but it certainly did strain the time of the head coach. Now back in the shotgun, goes White on second down and 19. They throw a screen to Clayton, who has blazing speed, puts it down, goes after it, as Lavallee comes off the defensive front to make the play. Well, here's our Aflac trivia question. Oklahoma and LSU have met only once before, which is hard to believe, in the 1950 Sugar Bowl. And who was Oklahoma's quarterback that day back in 1950?
It appears that Oklahoma on third down is very, very leery of throwing deep downfield. They don't think they can hold up in the pass rush on Jason White.
So they need to try to hit something underneath. And the whistle prior to the snap thrown on the far side and indicating a timeout being called by LSU. So that would exhaust their timeouts here in the first half. So we'll take a break.
Ford F-150, built Ford tough. New Lay's stacks, not just stackable, irresistible. And Charles Schwab, seeing the market from a different perspective, yours.
The bright lights of the Crescent City, the Big Easy. This has not been an air show here tonight, folks. One quarterback thrown for 28, Gary, and the other 12.
Yeah, but this guy, Jason White, has to play A ball for his team to win. Matt Mock only has to play C ball for his team to win.
Third down, 18 yards the Sooners need on this play. White dances to the right, on the move, incomplete. And it's fourth down. So after inheriting field position at the 35 following the Perkins punt return, they now squander that advantage against this LSU defense. And Blake Ferguson drops onto the field. When you take a look at third downs for Oklahoma, they are 1 of 5 as Nick Saban continues to keep them in third and long here tonight.
Nice hold up by Tommy Lehman right there as the slot man over the gunner started to come from the right side of the screen.
Speed from the corner. Runnels has got him. Here's Green letting it go over his head, and Ferguson has dropped one inside the 10-yard line. Just inside it, there is a penalty flag. You can see it on your screen. Our referee, Dennis Hennigan, goes down to get it all sorted out in this game in which Oklahoma has only 48 yards of offense against this LSU defense. They could do nothing with field position at the Tigers' 35-yard line.
I'll tell you, Brent, that last third down play, Travis Daniels took on Mark Clayton. You can see personal foul. They hit the Skylar Green in that play. But go back to that third down play. Watch this coverage by Travis Daniels. Started the year out as a safety, but when LaRon Lundy came on as a better player, it allowed Daniels to move back to corner, and here you see hitting the receiver and get the ball. That's going to be a penalty, an obvious penalty on Oklahoma.
And that was Brodney Poole, the defensive back, who was guilty.
Personal foul on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Repeat fourth down.
Stoops wants an explanation.
This is very interesting. Because the play wasn't over and there was a personal foul during the play, they will repeat fourth down. So instead of tacking it on with LSU's ball right from there, since they never had possession of the ball, they're going to repeat it.
So they'll back Ferguson up again. And remember, the nation's number one punt returner, number 5, Skylar Green, who has scored the touchdown tonight on an end around, will back it up. I remember the last championship game here in New Orleans. Peter Warwick standing right back there for Florida State against Virginia Tech, and Michael Vick fielded it and took it to the end zone for a touchdown that helped propel the Noles to a national championship. Ferguson, this one a little bit low. Green on the run. Dances, but not past Lehman. Man, what great coverage by a starting Will linebacker getting down the field. And remember, he was the up back in that formation. LSU ball. We we come back. One of the lucky ones. Probably underneath that, he's got the LSU cap under that second one there. First down and 10. Complete. Henderson to the 26-yard line. And, you know, in talking about Matt Mock, we talked to him about his strength as a quarterback.
I think the one thing I really try to do is realize that, you know, I might not be the biggest, the fastest guy, but, you know, we've got a lot of those guys on the team. So if I can get the ball to them and let them, do the hard work, we'll have success.
So he understands his role perfectly, manages this offense for LSU, has them ahead 7-0 here, second quarter of the Nokia Sugar Bowl, this year's BCS championship game. Second down and 8 for the Tigers. Green comes over to the right side of the formation, play fake. Linebacker in hot pursuit. Mock, an excellent runner. And he is crushed before he can get back to the line of scrimmage that time. So we have had one touchdown and a whole lot of defense in this game so far. Only 48 total yards for Oklahoma and 117 for LSU. 64 of them for the Tigers came on their first play from scrimmage when Vincent bolted up the middle before Strait saved a touchdown with a tackle. But not before the Tigers had some excellent field position. Then they fumbled it back inside the 5-yard line. And it wasn't until Corey Webster intercepted a pass that the Tigers on 3rd and 2 were able to score on an end around. Third down. Clayton's off the line. Mount can't get to him. And Nicholson forced him up into the pocket where there was more pressure. So number 8, Dante Nicholson, destroyed the play, and Rodney Poole cleans up on it.
Now, both guys for LSU, the fullback and the tailback, both missed their blocks on the play. Can't do this. Watch this. Two guys come, two guys whiff, and the quarterback has no chance. Inside, whiff, whiff. Boy, that's not good. There's nobody quick enough against him to get away from two guys. Except his name is Michael Vick when we were here last time.
Now remember, there's a new long snapper for LSU, Gant Petty. So far, he's been very accurate. They got it. There's the block punt recovered at the 2-yard line. First and goal all week long. Bob Stoops himself worked here in the Superdome with his punting team. He said we can get one. He continued to preach it. And now they've given themselves an opportunity to tie this football game.
It's Brandon Shelby. Look at those wide sprint splits. Wide splits. Here it comes from this side. Brandon Shelby, number 5, is the guy who gets it. Clean run. Lays out. Two guys could have got it, actually. Shelby's the one who gets it. And then it's Russell Dennison, number 36, who falls at it. And that's that big play again that Lynn talked about in the open. Might come on a punt return, but it's special teams that can usually turn a game.
Jones will be the running back. Runnels the lead blocker. They switch the power of the formation over to the left-hand side. On the toss, Jones for the end zone, battling, and he has stopped just short of it against this LSU defense, and it will be second and goal as Lionel Turner out of Walker, Louisiana.
Well, that was the guy that really came on in this defense from the linebacker spot. LSU fans know, beginning of this year, they thought, can we replace Brady James? Lionel Turner was an outside linebacker. He shifted inside. They brought up Eric Alexander.
They want timeout on the Oklahoma sideline. Not sure they got the personnel they want. They do not get it signaled in time. They move the strength again to the left-hand side. Play fake. White fires for it. Incomplete. And now it is 3rd and goal.
That was a great play. Corey Webster rips that ball out. I don't know if it was dropped before he hit it. But what discipline by that defense for LSU. They ran two guys out to the left side of the formation. They're covered, forces Jason to go backside, throws a strike, and Clayton should have caught that ball.
What a fierce goal line stand so far. In two plays, they have yielded only 1 yard against Oklahoma, the highest scoring team in the nation. Now they shift power over to the wide side. Runnels still the lead man. Here comes Jones, powering straight ahead. Penalty flag is thrown. A penalty flag is thrown. Certainly no indication at any time of a touchdown.
would have been two possibilities lined up in the neutral zone against LSU could be one.
That's our indication. Half the distance, so they will lose about half a yard.
Yeah.
Now, at this point, you really now wonder about Jason White being able to follow center Vince Carter into the end zone. Now, against that is the fact that he has undergone major knee operations in the left and the right in each of the previous 2 years. They don't like to expose him in this situation, but he is so close right now that with Joseph on the right, Carter in the center, Chayshon in the left, they should be able to power in here. They hand it off. Touchdown. Jones crossed the plane. We are an extra point away from being tied in New Orleans.
It wasn't so much of the down the distance that the penalty caused, but the extra down gave Oklahoma an opportunity to run one more play, the fourth of the series, and even though it was third down, that punt block gets Oklahoma's offense off the nine. Because defensively, Oklahoma has found their game.
Now, Trey DiCarlo, who struggled during the pregame warmups, kicking field goals from about 40 yards out, is on to attempt the extra point. He has missed two extra points this year. Not this one. Now he has kicked 73 extra points. But it was all set up because of Bob Stoops' aggressive play on the special teams. His offense going nowhere here tonight against LSU. He desperately needed a special team or a defensive unit to make a play. They did. Jones took it to the end zone. We're tied.
You're watching the Nokia Sugar Bowl on ABC Sports.
Whole lot of partying in this town this week. I got to tell you, two of the greatest groups of alumni for football, for college football, LSU and Oklahoma, and they have had a wonderful time here in New Orleans getting ready for this BCS championship game. DiCarlo with the ball on the tee to kick it off. Henderson and Green are back deep to return. There's speed and more speed, and DiCarlo said, let me just take it on into the end zone, take a knee. Now remember our Aflac trivia question. In that 1950 Sugar Bowl, who was the winning Oklahoma quarterback? Well, let's go back and take a look. There he is. You recognize him under center. Come on, and that's the legendary Daryl Royal. Greatest coach in Texas Longhorn football history. Just a great, great player. Norman, Oklahoma. Hope the old coach is doing well and enjoying the game tonight. Always great to see him when we go down Austin Way. See the Longhorns. We lost to Tuffy there the other night to Washington State. They can't be too happy, and they've got to be amazed at this LSU defense. Remember, a year ago, Roy Williams and the Horns beat this LSU team in the Cotton Bowl. Play fake out now. Rolls to the left. Throws past the tight end because he had a receiver open downfield, and Devery Henderson, who can run a 4.3 40, had all kinds of daylight down there for a 20-yard gain.
You called it exactly right. If Matt Mauk doesn't complete that one, he might have to keep running because he had the tight end Eric Edwards wide open for a first down play. And when you pass up a sure completion to go downfield, you better hit it. Believe me. You better hit it. I like the moxie. They needed a big play. Had 114 yards going into that play, Brent. 64 of them on one play. They haven't moved anywhere since.
Now with a first down out at the 40. Play fake knock to Clayton. Close to the first down at midfield. And we remind you that Saturday, all the action and excitement of the National Hockey League returns to ABC. Wonderful regional matchups. You'll see the Avalanche of the Stars, Red Wings Bruins, and Rangers Islanders. The NHL on ABC Saturday at 1 Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. And check your local listings for the hockey game in your area. Probably got a lot of fellows from the National Hockey League if they're not playing tonight watching this game. These guys in the National Hockey League are just great, great sport fans, no matter what the game is. They go out to a racetrack every now and then, too, don't they? Here comes Knock, handing off. Good jump by Vincent, the freshman. What a beautiful run to the 36-yard line. A penalty flag is thrown at the 40. Clayton was there trying to open up a hole for him down there. He looked disgusted on the play. And it is against the offense.
And I think it was on Michael Clayton, or he saw it right there, one of the two. But, you know, that corner cat blitz from Derek Strait, and Vincent runs right through it, reminiscent of Derek Sproles. Remember Darren Sproles in that game? That was really the play of the game. Here's Strait. Watch him right in here. He kind of goes a shoe duster. He goes too low on the play, doesn't get the tackle, and there's the play. Very, very similar to that play when Sproles ran right through that tackle and changed the game for Kansas State.
.656 remaining here in the first half. John Saunders, the gang, of course, coming your way at...
penalty was from the spot, so when they brought the ball back, it was still a first down.
Gary, that was one of the best runs past the line of scrimmage that I've seen in a long time.
He's got some talent. This is a guy.
He seems to get in a hole and then dance for daylight. You know, he's got that little scoot move between tackles. This is the first time we've seen him in the flesh. He's a dandy. Mount got to hurry now. They've had a little bit of clock trouble here.
No timeouts either.
Clayton's got to get over the left side of the formation.
Uh-oh.
Penalty flag didn't get it off, did he?
No, both receivers were moving on the play.
And the completion to the running back, Joseph Addai, and so it'll come back there.
Well, Nick Saban just going berserk on the sideline right now. These self-inflicted wounds. I mean, that's just line up in your proper spot. Two receivers shifted on the play just as the ball. Watch the top of your screen right here. Watch how they both shift at the same time. Oh, that don't work. You can only have one of those guys moving.
Thought it was back in Toronto, you know.
Right.
Let's go down below to Lindsmore, Len.
Well, Brent, both these teams haven't played the game since December 6th. That's a month that they've been without playing a football game. You get into a big game like this, little things are off. Receivers aren't used to being contested. They have to take a little time to get up to game speed. The coaches are just having a problem trying to be so detailed about every play, getting it in, and that's the problem with the clock management tonight.
Oh, my friend Len, standing up for the receivers again. Second down, Mock keeps it, and he crosses the 45-yard line.
Funny how it didn't hurt USC's receivers.
No, they kind of broke
free. They seem to be able to, well, Lynn's old school.
What was it exactly that they did during a month off that these fellas haven't?
Well, they focused a little more on catching the ball.
I must tell you, folks, ladies and gentlemen, I know many of you, especially Southern California, wondered, how did Lynn Swann handle it? He has been so elegant here in New Orleans and so gracious to both these teams. And the Nokia Sugar Bowl, folks, he's not claiming any national championship. He's not bragging about that great Trojan effort out there. So it is third down from the 45-yard line, and Mouth underneath. First down, and then some, as David Jones breaks a tackle and makes it to the 30-yard line.
Just slipping one guy out, two receivers come inside, and Matt Mock puts this ball exactly where you have to. Jones, big tight end, fullback, right on that hip, catches it. Poor tackle in the secondary by Oklahoma, and he turns up and gets positive yards. You know, Mock is a gamer. You watch the guy in practice and you go, yeah, you know, all right, he looks pretty good. When he gets in the game, he's much more comfortable than he is in practice.
We're going to have Clayton throw it. He's going to go to the end zone. Receiver's covered and it's out of bounds anyway. It'll be second down and 10. Well, that's 14th at 9, 8 Central on ABC.
If Bob would have picked her, he'd still be hooked up, I think. That's who the Danielson family all chose right there. Meredith was our winner.
Good for you. I was watching an NBA game. It's okay. Second down and 10 at the 30-yard line. High formation look now, a little motion. Anderson with that speed. They hand to Vincent. Vincent sprints inside the 25, the freshman to the 16, and he looks like he's going to be something, doesn't he?
He really is good. You know, I mean, this guy practiced 9 days in spring ball and defense. Nick Saban put him trying to find a spot. Started out the year fourth string, but watch him feel it. Freshman, he went through a spring practice, actually practiced with the team last year in the Cotton Bowl, sat out a year, but he has really taken now, built his way up, and a good football player.
He's over 100 yards now for the fourth consecutive game.
Wow,
he has passed Dalton Hilliard's freshman rushing record. So he has put the new standard up for LSU. Here he comes again. Still on his feet. Touchdown, Vincent. Amazing performance. First, he breaks open the SEC title game with that 87-yarder, and now he bolts LSU ahead here with a splendid 18-yard touchdown run. Oh, my.
Watch him use the umpire to cut off the last would-be tackler. Sets him inside and then goes around, and you can't get there because you see the umpire and you run off him. What a brilliant run.
And the extra point is up and good. Ryan Godet makes it a 14-7 game. Well, Herschel Walker exploded in this setting at the Nokia Sugar Bowl. Could it be Vincent tonight? He's on his way. LSU leads the Nokia Sugar Bowl over Oklahoma 14-7. Justin Vincent out of Lake Charles, Louisiana. He says his hobbies, folks, are deer and rabbit hunting. There better be a quick rabbit to get away from that young man right down there. Now, let me tell you, he doesn't need a gun. He just goes out there and runs him down.
They couldn't grab him either. Oklahoma missed a tackle up front, missed a tackle on the second level, and he just ran into the end zone.
Jackson with the ball on the tee, and LSU ahead for the second time here tonight. They have Mark Clayton on the field as a return man. Get the ball in his hands any way they can. And he is down at the 14-yard line. There's Brazil, another of the speedsters, coming down with that defensive unit. Man, if he can learn how to catch a football in traffic, he's going to be some dandy, folks. He's one of your 4-3 runners. Well, coming up on the BMW X3 Halftime Show, John Terry and Craig will break down the first half with former Oklahoma head coach Barry Switzer. Plus, we'll go live to Bourbon Street. Man, there were some times if you wanted to talk to Barry, you would go live.
Yeah, that's right. Jason White is 6-for-15 in this football game.
Ronald staying in with that H-back look that time. The inside handoff, trying to get the running game going. Jones battles his way out to the 19-yard line. You know, speaking of running backs, I must say this before we get too long into the night because I'll forget it.
Alert, but everyone, alert. This is the Adrian Peterson alert.
Here it comes, ladies and gentlemen. You folks in Norman, you got a great running back headed your way. At least I hope he's as good as I've been told. But Adrian Peterson, he pulled that OU hat right out of that bag at that Army All-Star game yesterday. And he's coming, I believe he carried that ball about 15, 16 times a game for them. Here's Jones coming back. Ooh, nothing doing against this front. What a play by Marquise Hill.
Man, these two bookends, Marquise Hill and Marcus Spears. You got two guys like that. There's two different styles of defense. One is a one-gap defense up front where you ask your guys up here to just get upfield. Nick Saban doesn't let his defensive linemen go one gap. He says push, cover two gaps. That's the style they have. You got to have strength. You got to control your offensive linemen. That way you have more guys covering more gaps. That is what he teaches.
And they have yielded only 54 yards to Oklahoma in this game. The Sooners' long touchdown set up by a blocked punt. White, good job of the offensive line until then. It broke down. He kept the ball too long. Good coverage, and Marquise Hill came free on him again with the sack.
Wes Sims is the guy who had Marquise Hill on that one. I thought it was decent. I thought it was decent protection that time. You got a blitz coming, four from one side, two from the other. Time. Long. This is a quarterback that isn't used to this type of pressure. It happened in the second half of the season.
Marquise Hill made all three tackles in that series.
Yeah,
and now
series.
Fergus is backed up in the end zone for Oklahoma. And LSU would like to repay the favor if they can get in on this punt. They'll settle for some field position and a return. Fair catch by Green at midfield. John Terry and Craig, what have you got planned for us at halftime?
Well, coming up on the BMW X3 halftime report, we'll break it down. The crowd, obviously, in favor of LSU, and they've dominated.
Yes, they've dominated the line of scrimmage. If Oklahoma doesn't block a punt, they don't win this game.
And you know what? On that last play there, Oklahoma, they only get three people out in the route. I'll show you what LSU did on offense that last drive to get in the end zone. Oh, you need to make an adjustment.
Plus, we'll be joined by Oklahoma coaching legend Barry Switzer. Brent.
All right, John, make sure you show me that interception by the Packers. I haven't seen it yet. I was busy doing something up here. Mock is back. On the roll, receivers are covered, and so Mock changes direction, and he picks up 3 yards before he is down. So Mock, who was a sensational running quarterback in high school, and of course he suffered that foot injury, he had to rehab that foot, and then, as we told you the story, selected baseball, Jack.
Well, Brent, so how did he end up with the LSU Tigers? We'll tell you after this play.
Second down, and Mock out of bounds. And Jack, that was a pretty good phone call that Nick Saban accepted that day.
Yes, indeed it was. But Nick Saban got the phone call because he knew of Matt Mock, because Matt was playing in the minor league organization for the Lansing Lugnuts when Nick Saban was at Michigan State University. They hit up with a friendship. Nick says he used to go to a lot of the games and he would watch. And then when it was time, he decided that he would go and call Nick Saban, and Nick said, come on down to the bayou.
And Jack, during that, I think they decided that wasn't a catch over there on the far side, because they brought the ball on back to the line of scrimmage between the 47 and the 48-yard line, so it will be 3rd and 7.
Good lesson to all the coaches out there. Be nice to the guys you don't sign. They may come back. This looks like a blitz look here for
There are OU. Four wide receivers
they come.
For LSU. And they leave Undai alone. One of the blitzers changed his mind. Derek Strait going over, but again, we've got a penalty flag on the play.
That was, one of those offensive linemen grabbed one of the blitzers on that play, but that was very bad technique for Oklahoma that time. All out blitz and let the remaining running back just clean go out that time. Someone is responsible to peel with that butt, with that back.
Well, Jimbo Fisher now will reach into his bag of plays and see what he can come up with here on 3rd and long. LSU coming off its best series of the game, now having some self-inflicted difficulties against the Sooners. There is Jimbo in the LSU coach's box. Someday, he too will become a head coach, but he's very, very comfortable working with Nick Saban, directing the offense. Obviously, Nick Saban is a hands-on defensive coach and pretty much leaves Jimbo away after they go over the base game plan. Now Mock is back. Fires downfield. Clayton overthrew and picked off at the 15-yard line. Antonio Perkins is out of bounds after the interception. Not particularly a well-thrown ball that time.
No, Brent, but not a disaster. When you've had your last punt blocked and it's 3rd and very long, you're going to throw the ball downfield, take a shot. If it gets intercepted, you tackle the guy. There's only 53 seconds left in the half. I think it's a good call by Jimbo Fisher.
So after the big warning, now unsportsmanlike conduct is going to be called. Bob Stoops. Cale Gundy just took the headset off over there, looking at the head coach. Because obviously it has been called against them after the interception. And Lynn, did you have a good view of that?
I had a great view of it. One of the players on the bench just came onto the field and was yelling, probably berating one of the players from LSU on the field right in front of the official. And the flag just flew right out of his pocket.
Oh, then that's a good call if that's what happened down there. No question of it. You can't have that, right, Gary?
Bobby threw his headset down, and he must not have seen it as clear as Lynn, because right now he might be working for the next one. But with 53 seconds to go, this half is over.
So we're at the top of the hour. LSU and Oklahoma at the Nokia Sugar Bowl for the BCS National Championship. 7-point lead. LSU with some personnel problems, but now the 12th man clears the field in time. Here's Jones going nowhere. Stoned by Eric Alexander, the senior from Port Arthur, Texas. And coaches will tell you the most improved defensive player on their team is number 27.
One of the keys to this great defense was Alexander's move from safety, where he was a three-year player trying to find the field. LSU fans know he was a terror on special teams, but you move an average safety up the linebacker, and he's a fast linebacker. He's making plays all over the field.
How tough is it getting for OU's offense? Chris Chester, coming off many injuries, now checks in, and they're going to run this clock out. They are content to go on into the locker room, trailing by 7 points. Lavallee and the defense did a great job as we check in with Jack.
Well, Coach, outside of just a couple of miscues and that one block punt, how do you rate it so far?
Well, you know, special teams play a big part in games like this, and they made a big play on it. Defense has played pretty well. I really like the last drive we had offensively, so hopefully we can develop more consistency there.
Let's go to the OU side and Lynn Swan.
Thank you, Jack. Coach, this offense that you're running has a tough time with this number one defense in the country. How do you squeeze a little more productivity out of it?
I mean, the number one scoring defense in the country. They are. We're the number one total defense in the country. And the bottom line is turnovers penalties have hurt us, taking away two turnovers. Penalties have put us into long yardage. On top of that, bad tackling on defense. Outside of that, we got a heck of a game.
Coach, thank you.
Not a happy camper. Bob Stoops, to say the least. John Saunders. And the gang coming up here with LSU leading Oklahoma 14-7.
This is the national championship game of the Bowl Championship Series on ABC Sports. The Nokia Sugar Bowl continues.
Come on, everybody, take a trip with me. Down to Mississippi, down to New Orleans. Ever set sail from the Mississippi Queen, it's down to Mississippi, down to New Orleans. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I said, look up.
It's the Nokia Sugar Bowl, the BCS championship game, LSU leading 14-7. And folks, have we got a story out of whack.
Yeah, if you're Oklahoma and you build a team around a Heisman Trophy quarterback, this is scary music and a scary stat right
here. I'll tell you what's about this, folks. A few years ago when Bob Stoops won his national championship, he beat up on a Heisman Trophy winner, Chris Winkie. And now tonight, the shoe's on the other foot. But, Gary, they got to do something to move the football here, Oklahoma.
They really do. As much as you want to try to establish the running game, I don't think they can do it. Oklahoma just does not run the ball. They've gone all these games with a shotgun pass offense. They're worried about protecting Jason White. I understand that, but that's all they got.
They have get the to ball throw to start the ball. The second half.
They have to throw the ball.
Maybe they can return a kickoff for a touchdown here to get something going. But the LSU defense is as good as advertised. And speaking of adjustments, Gary, let's take a look at our Home Depot coaching adjustments that you suggest right now.
Well, you know, to maybe get an advantage in this football game, how about Oklahoma try a no huddle? Try to take LSU out of their comfort zone. And on defense, they got to start tackling. They've been missing tacklers. LSU, on offense, protect the football. They're moving it. Their defense is making plays. So don't give Oklahoma another short field. And defense, you got them. Just more of the same. You got the game plan. You got the athletes. More of the same.
Well, before we get the second half kickoff, let's check in with our fellows down below. Let's start with Jackaroo. Jack?
Well, Nick Saban let me into the locker room. It was a very NFL-type locker room. They hydrated. They kept it very businesslike. And then Nick Saban addressed the team and said, look, forget about the scoreboard. I don't want to see any of you looking up. There's 30 minutes of football, and we've got this team where we want them to be. One thing Lynn Swanee did talk about is the center getting up quicker and snapping and getting his hands on the ball.
Jack, I talked to Chuck Long, and I asked him about the passing game and how you get it back on track. He indicated he felt the receiver and the quarterback were just too tight, and they have to play looser. But more importantly, Bob Stoops was livid as he left the field, and he stopped the official wanting to talk to him about the calls on the field. I don't know if that would backfire against him, Brent.
All right, Lynn, we'll wait and see how that storyline unfolds. And another kickoff into the end zone, and so Jason White bring the offense out. And in the first half, we had several key plays unfold. For the Sooners, it was this block punt, which led to their only scoring drive of the game. And it took four snaps to get that touchdown. Jones finally battling into the end zone. There has been nothing easy against this LSU defense. They have yielded only 44 yards and one touchdown, which followed a blocked punt and a recovery inside the 5-yard line. So what a defense here tonight for LSU. Jason White back in the shotgun to open up the second half. Off the fake, he'll keep the ball, and he is down at the 18-yard line. Marcus Spears, the junior from Baton Rouge, making the stop for the Tigers.
All right, come on now, Oklahoma. You can't, offensive line cannot hold up that long. You have to go out, throw the little short options. You have to attack them quickly. You don't have time to run these type of plays 15, 25 yards downfield. Establish the short passing game, hit the little options, and then maybe something else will open up.
Second down and 13 for our Heisman Trophy winner. Intercepted. LSU has scored on the Marcus Spears interception, the second play of the second half, and suddenly the Sooners are down two touchdowns. That was reminiscent of what happened back in Kansas City against Kansas State.
Yeah, this time it was a defensive end, Marcus Spears. He was one of the highest recruited athletes in the South, a tremendous basketball player. He drops from the defensive end position and gets the pick.
O'Day tacks on the extra point. And Jason White, back in the gun, didn't see him lurking there, was looking for Wilson on the cut. And Spears takes it to the end zone. What a defense. Marcus Spears, number 84, out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. At one time, he was the number one rated tight end prospect in the United States. So you know he brings speed to that defensive end position. And LSU now has 7 defensive touchdowns this season.
And he balked at being moved to the defensive side of the ball. He played one whole year here at LSU at tight end, but I think Nick moved him to the right spot.
This one will be returned by Clayton. And a lateral to Bradley, and it is eaten up down at the 5-yard line. And White, Chad White, number 43, was not to be fooled on the trickery by the Sooners.
Boy, are they on their game. LSU is on top of their football game. A reverse, a pitch, you come running down on it. One blink, one side, and then a head-up tackle on Bradley.
It's all uphill now for Jason White and the Sooner offense. Jason is only 6 of 16 throwing the ball. They keep Runnels in. Line up with a fullback directly in front of the running back in this formation. There's Jones, nothing doing against that defensive front. Let's go back to the interception, Gary.
You know, Jack told you what it was like in a NFL locker room at halftime, he said. But here's what it's like to play against an NFL pass defense, because you got defensive linemen picking off passes. They didn't used to do that when I played. This is the new style of defense.
Gary wants to outlaw it.
Exactly. It's not American. It really is.
They all zone blitz.
Every guy that anybody that ever played quarterback, write your congressman today.
Second down. Try to put it in Wilson's hands, and nothing doing against this savage defense. If things continue right now, Gary, and I think you would agree with me, LSU is playing for votes against USC.
Oh, yeah.
With this defensive performance here today.
I don't want to write off Oklahoma yet in this football game. You said it the right way. If things continue. But, you know, USC got a bit of a walkover in that football game. Michigan just didn't play their game that day, and you're seeing a defense. I don't know, this is as good a defense as I've seen all year.
Third and 9. Well, complete. Wilson breaks free, but only briefly, to the 43-yard line as Jack Hunt. Safety there to help out with Webster, but it is a 33-yard gain. Wilson shaken up on the play. He might have to come to the sideline.
Middle read this time. Gets inside Randall Gay, the nickelback, and look at that throw. Jason White's best throw of the football game. Gets it inside, and Jason White, by the way, also came up limping after that play. Wilson with the shoulder, it looked like, and Jason with the knee, foot, hip, or something, because he was left.
So Saban's defense dominating. Clayton on the end around. But look how they hold their position and stretch that play out. But then with Clayton's great speed, he gets the first down and gets the corner turn, coming back on a one-man reverse.
This is a great answer from Oklahoma now. Third and long, Jason White hits the first down. Now on the reverse. The big players for Oklahoma. White hits the first down pass, and now Clayton against a perfectly defensed sweep from the wide receiver. His great athletic ability gets something out of nothing. 15 yards on that play.
The ball at the 42-yard line, first and 10 for White and the Sooners.
This is what I'm looking for from Oklahoma. Do they have that heart of a champion? Can they pick it up in this game?
Jones and Peoples are the wideouts over to the right, and Jones comes through the formation to the left. So Webster backs off from the bump and run. They throw a screen to Jones on the other side, and it was read brilliantly by Lionel Turner. So, you know, we have talked to Nick Saban about a lot of things, including his defensive philosophy.
I think you win or lose every down on defense based on the next down and distance situation that you create, because the offense will become more predictable for you if you're in a positive down and distance situation defensively.
And he created a second and 10 with that well-read screen pass that time. Four receivers, the tight end coming in as an H-back, and an inside handoff to Jones, but Jones makes the most of it inside the 40-yard line before Melvin Oliver makes the stop for the Tigers.
When you talk to a lot of defensive coordinators around college football, they felt that the Achilles heel for Oklahoma was their offensive line was a finesse offensive line. A lot of teams felt they knew how to stop them, just didn't have the athletes to stop them. Now these last two games, Kansas State and now LSU, have enough athletes to match up, and they're forcing that Oklahoma offensive line to come through. Kevin White has to call on his front guys to start making some plays.
Travis Wilson came off the field. He tried it on a play. Now he is back over on the sideline. White hits Donnelly. Donnelly is down close to the 30-yard line, but there is a flag.
I think it was delay of game.
Prior to the snap, delay of game, offense, 5-yard penalty, and third down.
Well, you know, we had Saban mic'd up at practice in Baton Rouge, and he's worth a listen all the time.
That's it, Jesse. That's it, Jesse. That's the way to keep your feet inside. We want him 5-yard gain, not 10. This ain't a rodeo, dog.
And, yeah, not a rodeo, dog. He broke in under Jerry Glanville. That's where he learned how to talk like that with the Houston Oilers. Later under Bill Belichick with the Cleveland Browns. White's in trouble.
Right, it's
had to throw that one
it's
away. And here comes the penalty flag. Yeah. Intentional grounding as he was in the arms of Turner again.
That was a blitz. Got out man. Give that one to the defensive coaching staff for LSU.
You are seeing one example after another of why Saban is such a hot prospect in the National Football League.
Oh, boy, Ronaldo works. That's who you have to block. When you're the only running back, you have to block the middle linebacker. That's a complete bust. I got to take back what I said, Brett. That is a complete bust by the running back for Oklahoma. He should have been blocked.
Now, that man right there, Nick Saban, he has the biggest You can't really say wager, can you, with the NCAA? No. But anyway, if he wins this game, he gets $1 more than the highest salary coach in college football. He has it in his contract. And guess who the highest salary is? On the other sideline at $2.5 million, Mr. Bob Stoops. And right now, Nick Saban is headed for a big, big payday. I talked to the powers down at Baton Rouge a couple of nights ago. They think that they have him almost inked to a long-term contract. And they are not going to let the NFL have him without a fight. And Green did not fair catch it, so he's ripped down at the 11-yard line. So again, it is the special teams trying to hold Oklahoma in the football game. That was Will Peoples.
A Sugar Bowl. This
back in New Orleans, and there's the backup quarterback Paul Thompson. Should the Sooners, and I'm not trying to suggest that any coach has to do anything, but should they go to Paul Thompson, they can change their look just a little bit. He's a little more agile, a little bit better runner because of Jason White's knee injuries. I'm not pushing for it. I'm just saying if they decide to go in that direction, it would give them a little more mobility at the quarterback spot. Speaking of mobility, the running back of this game so far is number 25, Justin Benson, the freshman from Lake Charles, Louisiana. Paul Carrier that time, and a reminder now the college basketball season in full swing. And Big Monday on ESPN, 7 Eastern, Texas against Providence. Man, what's it like watching Dickie V in high definition? Ooh, that's got to be scary. Then at 9, it's Kansas, Colorado. Big Monday.
Yeah, you're right.
On ESPN.
Stereo already.
Oh, yeah, baby. There's a play fake and Mock in trouble. Harris was closing in, and he's still able to complete the pass as he hit Eric Edwards, his tight end that time, and Derek Strait makes the stop.
Yeah, another one of those situations now. And if I was Jimbo Fisher, offensive coordinator for LSU, I'd be very careful here right now. You got this game well in hand. Your defense is controlling. You don't want to make a critical mistake right now. Some type of draw, some type of quick screen, maybe a wide receiver screen. Nothing over the middle where you lose track of a linebacker or a defensive end.
And they have Joseph Adai, veteran running back, to slip him into the formation, just what you suggested, and they pick him up for the first down before Strait can bust him out of bounds at the 35-yard line. So there was no risk on that play.
Right.
They stayed out of the middle, and Mock was efficient for 13 yards.
Boy, I'll tell you, Matt Mock, I really love his delivery. No wasted motion, very quick, very much like a catcher. Just flicks it off his ear, just zips it right out there. Very impressive. He's 24 years old, like you've mentioned. Very comfortable. You know that injury he had last spring? He looks more comfortable as a passer now. And I think that spring of not being able to scramble helped him.
It did, Gary. They say that he stayed in the pocket down there in spring practice a lot, just because of what you say. Wanted to run the draw, and he slipped on the surface that time, and Harris was able to take him down at the 30-yard line. And there is Tommy Harris, who also faces the decision as to whether or not come back to Oklahoma. He'll announce his decision after the game. And there's a very good possibility that Tommy will move on because so many scouts like him. Anytime you get a defensive tackle with 4.67 speed,
right,
you've got to be impressed. Tommy, the recent winner of the Lombardi Trophy, they won so much hardware. They're going to have to build a new wing at the Hall of Fame in Norman for all of the awards that this defense and, of course, the Heisman Trophy that these Sooners have picked up. And right now, they'd like to play a little bit better against LSU. Mock on the roll, takes off again. Crosses the 40, short of the first down.
Harris.
He is down at the 43-yard line and 11-yard run. But let me take you to the list of award winners. Jason, of course, you know. He also won the O'Brien, the AP Player of the Year. Teddy Lehman, the Butkus and the Bednarik. And Derek Strait, he won the Thorpe and the Nagurski. Harris, we just told you that. And Bob Stoops, on one of the polls, was a Coach of the Year. I think on another one, I think Nick Saban actually won the award, too. So the Sooners cleaning up in the hardware, but not closing out the season on a strong note, at least so far, after being beaten 35-7 by K-State and now trailing LSU by 2 touchdowns. Here comes Skylar Green, first down, and Strait makes still another tackle for the defense. I am mentioning Derek Strait's name too often. I should be mentioning the defensive front. So let's talk about the LSU offensive line for a moment. Let's talk about Wilkerson. Made a bad mistake early in the game. He's been efficient ever since. Peterman and Livings are the guards alongside of him, and Reed and Whitworth are those tackles. Now, I looked up the penalties on these fellas. Whitworth, only 6 this year. Livings, only 4 this year. And Reed, the right tackle, he's a 3.9 student in accounting. This is a very good offensive line. And Mauk very adeptly stepped away from Heat that time to the 50 carry.
That really the play of the game for Matt Mauk right there in my mind. That's exactly what Jimbo Fisher and Nick Saban told us they really love about Mauk. He saves us. He doesn't make the dumb play. He knows he's got a great defense to play with. So on that play, he's under pressure. He just doesn't lob it downfield. He goes up inside, and instead of having first and 10 or an interception or a sack way back there, he's got 2nd and 7. 2nd and 7 is manageable.
Harsha Jackson checks back in. 2nd down. Mauk zips it complete to Clayton. There's a 1st down inside the 35. What a job Matt Mauk is doing in this game. And, well, let's take a closer look at this young man.
My hometown is Jasper, Indiana. My favorite movie is Fletch. My favorite musical group would be U2. My favorite sports team would be the Chicago Cubs. They took a chance on me. It probably didn't work out, but it was great being a part of that organization.
Never had a chance to catch Mark Pryor. That's one of the things I asked him when I was visiting down in Baton Rouge. It is so ironic for me that the only national championship won by LSU some 40-some years ago, Billy Cannon was the star of that team, and he went on to become a dentist. And now Mauk is following in the same vein on a Vincent one-yard run that time as we check in down below with Lynn Swann. Lynn?
Well, Brent, the ADT National Champion Trophy is right here. This crystal football has been around for 18 years, has always been associated with the coach's poll. Traveled just over 25,000 miles this year, and there's only one team that has 4 of these sitting in his trophy case already, and that would be the University of Miami. However, if the score holds, LSU is looking to add their 2nd national championship and a little crystal to their own palace.
We got the right man watching that trophy. Never saw him drop a ball when he got his 2 hands on it. Here comes Mauk now taking off the right side. This will be a 3rd down coming up. And again, it was straight making the stop. And let's go down now to Jack.
Well, Brent, we watched the way this offense for LSU is operating, and it's the epitome of what Jimbo Fisher has explained to them. He says, we want you to play with boys. He says, except that the defense for Oklahoma is very good and they're going to get you once in a while. He said, don't make a play to win the game. Just go out and play the game.
Here's the 3rd down and 6. Jimbo's call is on the field. Now it's up to Mauk to orchestrate it. Clayton goes back over to the short side on the right. Mauk straight back. Offensive line gives him plenty of time. Nice grab. Here comes Skyler Green, and he's out of bounds. At the 5-yard line, it'll be 1st and goal. Poole getting him out of bounds, but LSU is in business again, and here come the Tigers.
Wow, that was on Derek Straight that time. He had Skyler Green man-to-man. It was a loop pass. You come inside and you loop back out. It's a predetermined option to the outside. Everyone knows what's going on. You come in, you fake hard inside, and that time Derek Straight could not handle Skyler Green. Skyler Green is very impressive with his speed.
Kerry, you mentioned 3rd down. That was 3rd and 6 and a 23-yard gain. Their 1st touchdown of the game, 3rd and 2. They are dominating. Justin Vincent is the running back. Got the call. Tiptoes inside the 5-yard line time as the Sooners jam the front.
You can always tell you're doing a good job against Oklahoma's defense when you don't hear Teddy Lehman's name a lot. You really have to scheme to keep that guy. He's like a wild card. He's like a rover. And he has not been in any plays tonight. Passing game, he can't get there. Running game, he's there. He's bouncing it outside. But LSU has schemed him out of this game.
2nd down and goal. Vincent DeLone running back. Henderson through the formation. Mauk rolls to the right. Pump fake, keeps it out of bounds. Just shy of the 5-yard line. So it'll be 3rd down coming up for LSU. And a quick reminder that DC, viewer discretion is advised.
LSU likes the wide receiver screen coming inside, the jailbreak screen down here on 3rd down. Let's see if they can get one in. It will be safe. Remember, a field goal makes it more than a 2-possession game with a 17-point lead.
Oh, they've gone to 4 wideouts. And then they'll bring Henderson over to the left side, and Mauk will roll hard in that direction. And this one did not work out. It's field goal time for Nick Saban at LSU. Dan Cody along with Garon Allen, making the stop for the Sooners.
Nothing silly. Great drive by LSU. Managed very well by Moff. He scrambled when he had to. He hit the passes when he had to. And when he had to, he just kept the ball and made sure the field goal was alive.
So here's Ryan Godet, who took over, kicking the field goals for Chris Jackson in the SEC Championship game in Atlanta. Hit two field goals against the Bulldogs. And he's got this one. There's a penalty flag. The field goal is signaled good. But there is a penalty, and we'll get this sorted out. It was a 27-yard field goal.
Oh, that's big.
I'd say. You wonder if Oklahoma can spring somebody either directly up the middle, which frequently is the easiest way to block a field goal. Those edge rushers have a terrible time sometimes. Get around that corner and lay it out.
There are two penalties, one during the play, one after the play was over. During the play, holding on the offense. After the play was over, personal foul on the offense. Both penalties will be enforced.
They'll have to punt.
Bring the punter on.
Yep, they're going to have to punt.
Now, one thing about Donnie Jones, he can nail it inside the 20-yard line. He has been lethal doing that this season.
Right now, LSU is discombobulated. They got half their field goal team out, half their punt team. The worst thing would not be just to take a 5-yard penalty and calm down on this thing. I'm surprised they're trying this long field goal. Two and a half yards.
Lane Besh is the holder. It's a fake. They throw out of it, and wide open is David Jones. Can you believe it? That's why they were taking so much time.
What a play.
And they pull the fake field goal. But remember now, it's a 29-yard gain.
Right.
They were down to the 5-yard line at first and goal. So they improved their field position.
Bob says, I'm supposed to do that. That's the type of play I would call. I haven't seen this ever. It's one of the great plays. A penalty after a field goal. You get the split receiver. Jones comes out, runs down. He has to score because it was first and goal, and he does not get in. But they got field position out of it.
Sooner fans, take a big, deep breath. Still hanging in. The boys in the truck. It's high-definition night here at the Nokia Sugar Bowl. Okay, show them that high-definition monitor.
Yeah, this is it right here.
Right there.
It costs about $5,000.
There's Monty Poling. He's our TD on the left. And there's Larry Camp. There's Bob Goodrich over there, huh? So there's our three leaders down there. And Oklahoma dashes onto the field here with Vince Carter, the center. And, man, they're looking for something good to happen. They've got only 92 yards here tonight, only 31 rushing, 61 passing against this fierce LSUD. From the end zone, going for it all, and Clayton couldn't quite get to it. So the FedEx Brown Air Stats, we take a look at it, and you can see the air being won by LSU, dominated by the Tigers. And we don't have to tell you what the ground looks like. We already spoke about that.
Yeah. Boy, those two packages from Oklahoma didn't get there, did they? Those Christmas presents didn't get there from Oklahoma.
Second down and 10. Donnelly switches to the left side of the formation, keeping Runnels in because of the intense pressure all night long. Trying to get a running game going. You can see Carter trying to lead the way in the middle, and we check in now on the Jeep rushing playbook.
Well, when you run the spread, and Brent talked about bringing in the running quarterback, look what happens when you don't have a running quarterback. The defensive end doesn't respect the quarterback keep. He just cuts around the backside, tackles the ball carry. I don't care, Jason. You want to keep it and run it? We'll tackle you. You got to have that extra runner when you're in that shotgun and run the spread.
The Tigers looking down at third down and 6 here for the Sooners. The Sooners are 3 of 9 on third downs here this evening. Saban's defense has him 6 yards away. Jason dances, tries to find an open receiver. Clayton on a comeback. And he's got his first down.
I think they had a lineman downfield, illegal lineman downfield. I think it was Wes Sims. Tremendous coverage. I'm telling you, if you've got people that can cover like this, I don't care if you have two Heisman trophies. Watch these guys cover. You show me where to throw the ball. Go ahead. Come on, Oklahoma fans. Tell Jason where to throw the ball. Should you throw it to this guy? No. How about that? No. How about this guy? Any one of these three guys you'd like to try to throw the ball to? I don't think so.
Excellent. You know, Gary, we started this podcast with a piece of sound with Nick Saban talking about the bump and run. And all night long, they have used that defense, busting those wideouts. And you saw Nick hands-on coaching the defensive backs in Baton Rouge. Teaching them how he wants them to do it. The great coaches are great teachers, or they have great teachers working with them. But they all get it done in some manner. And Nick Saban, out of West Virginia, I've got a great story regarding the Stoops family I want to get to here a little bit later. Third down, and from the end zone, White, this one could almost be picked off Jones. I mean, Daniels had him covered like a blanket. Gary, there was just nothing doing over. There was no daylight, nothing going.
I'm really impressed with Daniels. You know, he started off at safety because of LaRon Landry. He got the move to corner. Look at this guy. He's tall. He looks at the hips. He tracks him. He gets his hands on him. Turns back for the football. He doesn't paddock. No interference call. Daniels is the guy that gave up his red shirt in the SEC championship a couple years ago for one play. That's a team player.
Skylar Green. Standing 45 yard line, Blake Ferguson near that end line. Booms it out.
This is returnable.
Catches it back at the 38 yard line. Searches for a crease. Stumbling. And back to the 34 yard line. Is in good shape again.
Forgive Skylar Green if he's just learning the role of kick returns, guys. You see, he was a quarterback at Higgins High in Marrero, Louisiana. And while he was a quarterback, he only returned two punts in his entire career. He's acquired the skill set pretty well. Yeah.
Probably for touchdowns with that speed, Jack. From the I formation. They're going to bring him out of the end around now, and nothing doing that time because Jonathan Jackson, the junior from Houston, is able to make the play. Jonathan Jackson, I was mentioning his name almost every play at the Rose Bowl last year when they beat Washington State, and I believe that might be the first time that I've mentioned it here tonight, just to give you an idea of the efficiency on both sides of the ball by this LSU team. They left nothing to detail. Yesterday when we were here in our final setup, and Nick Saban was going through his final walkthrough, I have never, ever seen a team as prepared. They just send their units out onto the field. I mean, there's nothing that goes on, basically. He just wants the kick team guys. He makes the substitution packages. And, man, it was like clockwork watching this bunch. Coming in underneath the Jones again, just short of the 30-yard line.
Oklahoma's defense is so distorted. That's such a simple little play. And for the corner to fall back that deep like that and let a quarterback on second and long throw a 3-yard pass and get it back to third and five like that is just bad defense. They're playing bad zone defense tonight.
LSU gonna let the time run out on the third quarter. Yeah, we're 15 minutes away from big party on Bourbon Street. That's an oxymoron. ABC Sports presentation of the Nokia Sugar Bowl will return with the fourth quarter after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
This is the Nokia Sugar Bowl.
Oklahoma, with only 79 yards of offense,
amazing,
back on the field defensively against Matt Mock and the LSU Tigers, who now have a third down. Oklahoma's only touchdown set up by a blocked punt, which was recovered inside the 5-yard line. It's four plays to get it in. Now Mock standing tall, fires intercepted. Bad decision on his part. Picked off now by Brodney Poole. And Poole, looking for somebody to lateral to, finally takes it down inside the 30-yard line. That's his seventh interception of the season. He leads the OU defense. And finally, a spark for Oklahoma. And maybe we can get something going.
Yeah, it's one of the things that LSU had to tell Matt Mock at the change of the quarter. If it's there, go for it. But make sure you throw under timing. Don't throw this ball over the middle off balance. He throws late off balance, and that ball is just eaten up, and Oklahoma stays in his football game. The missed field goal, and now the interception. It's anybody's football game.
Now let's see if OU can cash in on it. There is Poole, having picked off his seventh pass of the season. White comes up under center. Jones is running back. There's the pitch to Jones, and he is him back in. Beautiful defense by Daniels. Gary, you have talked about Travis Daniels, but he was so disciplined that time from the cornerback spot. He saw the possibility of a pitch. Instead of coming hell for leather for the running back, he stayed right there like he's taught to do and forced the back inside the truck. Man, that was, what an awesome looking defense this is.
Not only that, it's a smart defense. He knows the quarterback's not going to keep the ball. He follows his game plan and he does what he's supposed to do. Let the quarterback run, go for the pitch man.
Now they got him in second and long, and they got Jason White back in that shotgun. They work a twist. They hit him on a release.
There he is again.
Incomplete, and Jason White has taken another hit as Clayton is up against Daniels, and Travis gets the best of it.
That lineman was zone. Daniels plays the zone. Remember, he was the straight safety when this season started. This guy is a big-time foot. Remember, the other corner's the All-American. Webster's the All-American. Watch this. Drops in zone, reads the quarterback, and then gets back on the play. Runs it. Watch it. Jams, looks in, gives ground, relax, and tips the ball. That's wonderful pass defense.
That's two sensational plays in a row, and that is Kristen Pittman, I believe, the young man who is down on the 32-yard line. But the pressure again on the Heisman Trophy winner.
Yeah, he's been battered all night. He's had passes knocked down. He's been sacked. He's been harassed. He's been blitzed. He's had to dump the ball. But he's been making some plays.
Well, speaking of Heisman Trophy winners, you know, some of them have had a very tough time after winning the trophy. You go back to just a couple of years ago to the Rose Bowl, and Eric Crouch in Nebraska beaten by Miami. Chris Winkie was handled by the Oklahoma Sooners in Miami. Now, Danny Werfel here under the dome, won a national championship with Steve Spurrier as his coach. And Charlie Ward did likewise down at the Orange Bowl. So Jason White tonight is going to continue the negative streak the way it looks, unless they can score. They need to come up with a big play on offense. It has been so frustrating to watch them struggle and try to get anything going offensively. LSU has held them to 79 yards, 3 of 10 on third down.
You can see it with Jason's Bennett. It's like a heavyweight fight for Jason Wynn. If I was Oklahoma, I would look at this as four down territory. They need a touchdown. They don't have to get it all of it on third down.
LSU backs the safety out. Now he looks like he's coming, and he is coming. Jason White going to go for the home run. Middle, knocked away at the last moment by the nickelback Randall Gay, making still another big play. What a defensive backfield Saban has put together.
Randall Gay was the starter. He was the starting cornerback when Travis Daniels played safety. He comes on Clayton. The ball is slightly underthrown again. You see Gay, he's able to just bat it down. He doesn't panic. He's used to playing bump and run coverage, and he knocks it down. Wonderful play. And Oklahoma will go for it on fourth down.
Now they must get inside the 21-yard line for a first down. LSU. That defense now looks at a fourth and 11, and here they come again on White. He'll fire middle. Clayton reaches out and makes the catch for the first down at the 11-yard line. A wonderfully athletic play by Mark Clayton, who has a 38-inch vertical leap. the best on the OU team.
This matchup on the blitz against Jack Hunt worked early in the game, and they come back to it late in the football game. That's the only time Clayton's really had his way when he's been matched up against Jack Hunt. Give the offensive line credit for Oklahoma. It was an all-out blitz, and they blocked it.
Now if they can afford to send Runnels out, sometimes he breaks free down close to the end zone, but he is set up on the fullback on the straight eye with Jones behind him. Sooners looking for a touchdown to get back in this thing. Jones looking for that corner. Breaks free and then muscled down close to the 5-yard line.
That was a big-time play for Jason White. He stood in there the play before on third down. As you look at Juwan Jones,
He has led this team in rushing yards and TDs, 26 career games and 25 career touchdowns. He struck on that opening drive against Kansas State, and since then, it has been struggle city for the OU offense. Now they're looking down at second down and 5. Runnels still in as the fullback in front of Jones. Play fake. Throwing. It is complete. And Runnels dives for the flag this time, but he is just short of it. Runnels thought he had it. Runnels thought he got the pylon. And I told you about him slipping out sometimes for that backfield. It has been a wonderful play through this season for Oklahoma.
Lionel Taylor, the middle linebacker, has the fullback sliding out here. Looks like his foot came out of bounds right about there just before he hit the pylon.
There's the foot.
Yes, good call.
First and goal. Jones is behind Runnels. They switch the power over to the left side of this formation. Jason trips. Gonna keep it. Stumbling. Can't get there. Too much speed on that D, and Oliver is allowed to close. Jason had no chance once he slipped, and he gave back 4 yards.
And he missed the handoff on the play. I don't know if he slipped before the handoff or after the handoff, but he misses the handoff. Watch as he turns here. Yes, he slips before. He might have got his foot stepped on, and then he knew he was going to get eaten up on the play. He was never going to get outside of Melvin Oliver.
Peoples on as a wide receiver, and so look at the substitution package for LSU. 4 different defensive players dash onto the field after Oklahoma sends in its substitutes. White back in that passing shotgun formation. Jones slipping to the right. Fake. Quarterback draw. Dives toward the end zone. Just short of it. And it will be third down and goal, but that was a good call.
Absolutely. That's a great call. That's one of those calls you would never expect. Jason White is showing his heart in his football game. He's been limping all game. Brent mentioned the 2 surgical knees he had. Got both of those just running. Not even hit on either one of those plays early in his career.
Chris Chester.
4
comes
down
in
territory.
As a tight end to help lead the way. This will be a jumbo formation. Signal coming in from the sideline. This could make a whale of an ending here to the Nokia Sugar Bowl if Oklahoma can battle their way in. Jones burrows his way in. Touchdown, OU. Now, Garrett, look what we've got here. And Carlo McCoy holding, trying to make this a 7-point game. 74 extra points for him, and there's the man who's done all the touchdowns scoring for the Sooners.
That bad play by Matt Mock. You can't give up the ball when you're controlling the football game, and it gave the other team life. Inside move against Hunt. That's the matchup that Jason White has made before. And then the running play after the quarterback draw by Jason White to get back in the football game.
Well, Bourbon Street's been lively all week long with the fans of these two schools. LSU, of course, only 90 miles away. But Many of them are either here with us tonight or watching the game on television. Now, Gary, you picked this up. That is Jason White, the quarterback. And why are they taping that way?
I think it was a turf toe. When he sprained his, when he turned and slipped, that's how you can sprain your toe, that arch. They'll tape it up, try to give him support, but that will get sorer as the game goes on.
DeCarlo. And Skyler takes a knee in the season premiere Wednesday, January 14th at 9, 8 Central on ABC as the medical staff at OU continues to tend to their gutted quarterback who has undergone two major knee surgeries. He came back to win a Heisman Trophy, and he's still in this football game.
The Nokia Sugar Bowl.
More excitement than we've seen all night on the Oklahoma sideline as Mauch and LSU bring it out on first and 10 from their own 20-yard line. Fake to Vincent. Roll left. Dropped. It'll be second down and 10. During the commercial, this was the Oklahoma sideline, and they were dancing to the OU band right behind them there in the corner, trying to get their fans back in the thick of it. And I see an awful lot of folks wearing red on their feet right now as they have closed back to within seven, and they look at a second and 10.
That was that gimme pass that they ran before when he threw the comeback. This time he short-armed it, did Matt Mauch, and threw it right in the ground. It was a tough catch. The last time Oklahoma scored a touchdown, LSU answered with their own touchdown.
Timeout. LSU. They burn one here.
Welcome back. Let's take a look at the Pontiac High Performance Drive summary now. This is LSU's last three possessions. It hasn't been pretty. Two interceptions. Remember, this is where they got the field goal and had it taken off the board. So there's 3 points right there. And the last three possessions have gotten Oklahoma back in the football game.
Now, OU looking for a big play on defense. And who bigger than Tommy Harris? We asked him about his excitement about playing football.
Every time I see offensive line, it's just so fun to be out there again, and I just get happy, I get excited. And it's like a parent telling you about to go to like Six Flags or Astro World, and you can't sleep the night before, you're just so anxious. That's how I feel about the game.
Get excited now, Tommy. It's second down and 10. 21-14 Tigers toss Vincent. Vincent looking for daylight is cut off and thrown down at the 16-yard line, and suddenly that defense is coming alive. Allen was there, and Dvorak also helping out.
Well, that missed pass by Matt Mauch on first down got LSU behind the down and distance. We heard Nick Saban say we like to have the down and distance in our favor. Well, on the other side, you have the ASCII Oklahoma coaches. They like the same thing. When you miss that first down pass, get nothing. All of a sudden, that offense doesn't look so good. Remember, your quarterback, the last two passes he's thrown, a wrong-footed interception over the middle, and he short-armed a short pass to the outside.
The dime look with three down linemen for Oklahoma. Mauch stands in trouble. Cody had a hand on him. Came up firing, and he saved a huge loss on that play. Big Dan Cody came right over the top and had a hand on him, and Mauch pulled away and threw the incompletion.
Well, you got to admire this front. 39 sacks. These guys have come all year. Whitworth's doing a good job on Cody. Look at that balance. Good athlete, then just gets rid of it to save the distance. But boy, Oklahoma, the heart of a champion right now. Got the crowd against them. It's a big LSU crowd, and they're fighting back.
Jones back to punt. He's had one block tonight. Perkins is standing on his own 45-yard line.
You're not seeing those wide splits anymore. They got that one blocked.
The drive, Perkins back to the 39. He spins free. And then crashes into two defenders, bringing the ball back to the 41-yard line. Well, this march on ABC for the...
Let's keep an eye on Jason White now. First series since he had that toe all taped up. He doesn't have great mobility to begin with. Now he's got that toe to deal with.
They put him up under center. Clayton on the end around, swings behind Jones. Clayton dashes for daylight and gets close to 10 yards on that play as Jack Hunt makes the stop.
Boy, the go-to players for Oklahoma have come through. You could tell the way Perkins ran that ball on that punt return. Dan Cody almost getting that sack. Jason White hitting that big fourth down play. Clayton making that big fourth down catch. The big players for Oklahoma are starting to make big plays.
Bill Mazur, he was very close. You can see according to our yellow line, he's just that short. So it will be second down for Scoops and OU.
Now normally you would think Oklahoma would toss one deep here, but the way they've been having trouble running the ball on short yardage, they may try to run the ball twice and make sure they get this first down.
White looks over the sideline. Has the play call. ...21-14... LSU leading. They were up 21-7. An interception led to an Oklahoma touchdown. Donnelly over to the right side of the formation. Runnels still in there as the lead fullback. He's played most of this game. Flag prior to the snap. And so this will come back 5 yards against Oklahoma. And so they turn almost a gimme into an adventure here.
Offense, 5 yard penalty.
Live here in New Orleans at the BCS Championship game at the Nokia Sugar Bowl between Oklahoma and LSU. There, the interception by Poole, who has come on to be one of the Sooners' best defensive backs this year. Jones banging in for that touchdown, his second of the game. And Jones has carried 16 times for 33 yards and 2 touchdowns. Clayton is actually their leading rusher with 36 yards now on that end around. Second down, and here comes their leading rusher again. Fumble the ball out of bounds. Oklahoma football. No first down on the play, and third down is coming up.
One of the advantages that LSU has in defensing this particular Oklahoma offense at this stage right now, Oklahoma has become very predictable. They don't throw to the tight end anymore. Lance Donnelly is not even in it. He splits out. He's in there every play. They don't even look at him. The quarterback can't get out of the pocket. They become predictable, and that's why LSU has been able to stop them. They know where the attack is coming from.
And a fresh Marcus Spears checks into that defensive line. Four-man rush with a twist. Deflected incomplete by Marquise Hill. Hill on the twist, coming free. Knocked it back.
That was a huge penalty for Oklahoma. They're going to have to punt the ball here.
8:25 left in the fourth.
You can see him. There's the star of the game so far. Oh, it was the other one coming around this time. They're both good. They're both big. And they both can put their hands up.
Ferguson back to punt. And now it is Skylar Green's turn. Signal for the fair catch. Hopes it goes into the end zone, and it does. It'll come out on the 20-yard line. 8:17 to go here at the Nokia Sugar Bowl. It's 21-14. The Tigers up 7. What would Huey Long say about the Louisiana Superdome, huh? An overhead coverage of the Nokia Sugar Bowl provided by the Saturn Lightship. Saturn and its retailers hope you're enjoying ABC's coverage of tonight's game and wish you a happy and a very healthy 2004. LSU up 7. Matt Mock under center. Michael Clayton, number 14. One of his big guys has been rather quiet here so far. Play fake to Vincent again, rolling right, receivers covered, Mock takes it off, and he's down to the 27. Now, speaking of Michael Clayton, we talked about the strength of the LSU offense.
Games are won off big plays, and when you have six big play guys out there on the field, it's like your chances of winning goes up. And, from our receiving corps to our running backs are all guys who, once they get the ball, they can take it a distance.
And which of these teams now will come up with the next big play, which could be the biggest of the night? Michael Clayton out as a wide out here on second down. Now using the freshman, and Allen was in on top of him in a heartbeat. Didn't have a chance as Jackson came in and made the play.
LSU is a little gun shy about throwing the ball right now. Oklahoma is squatting on all the routes. They're daring him to throw deep, but Mock is 2 for 5 for 18 yards and an interception in his last 5 passes. He's missed a couple easy ones. He's made a couple bad mental mistakes and got it Oklahoma back in the football game. It looks like Jimbo Fisher and Nick Saban don't feel good about throwing the ball right now.
Third down and 5. 3 wide receivers from out. He'll take off and see if he can run for it. Stumbles and short of that first down, I believe, which would force Saban to punt.
Yeah, that field, that's a turf. That's the second time. Turf once for Jason White, now the turf for Matt Mock. Yeah, Nick knew he had a first down. Bob Stoops right now. Brent Venables is feeling good about their defense. They're squatting on the routes. They feel they got a quarterback that's aiming the ball, and they feel good about playing pass defense.
Perkins standing back on his own 30-yard line. Donnie Jones out of Baton Rouge. Straightening out a blocking assignment. Remember, the Sooners have blocked one punt already tonight. They're going to bring the clock down. They zero it out. That's not where you want to take a 5-yard penalty. Nope. I know he's a good punter, but he's not this good.
That's right. LSU had not had a punt blocked all year. They come into this football game, use the spread punt, get one blocked, and all of a sudden they start worrying a little bit, making a few too many calls, and they burn 5 yards.
Now Saban and his staff starting to feel the heat. Oklahoma climbing back into this. High snap is pulled down. Remember, it's a new snapper here. Long snapper was suspended for the game. There's the third catch at the 39-yard line. That's where Jason White and Oklahoma will have it. Trailing by 7 in the Nokia Sugar Bowl.
You're watching ABC's coverage of the Nokia Sugar Bowl.
One of the great stories in college football is number 93 of the LSU Tigers, Chad Lavallee. Could not get his grades, could not get the test scores up, so he worked as a prison guard for 1 year. Kept trying, made it. Now he's one of the best defensive linemen in the country, and he is looking to make a play here now. First down and 10. You can see him right over Carter's nose, man. He's going to war. Time to battle in, gets forced back out. Pass is complete. We asked Lavallee about his strengths as a lineman.
I'm not one of those guys that, like you said, just knocks someone off the ball. I mean, I can do it at times, but I try to use my speed and quickness to my advantage, you know, keep the linemen on their heels, because, you know, they'll be expecting that, and then I'll counter that with something else.
He was drawing a lot of attention that time, and Shashan, number 70, who's had 18 consecutive starts, did a great job of blocking on him. And this time, Jones, first down, Oklahoma.
That was impressive. When you try to stop the Oklahoma running game, you know they like to run off the edge. Sweeps, off tackle. LSU game planned it. Now watch them run outside. Good block by Sims. Missed tackle. Alexander misses the tackle, and they get a first down. With under 5 minutes to go now, you got to believe that Oklahoma's thinking it's 4-down territory the rest of the game.
They've crossed midfield. Donnelly, the H-back, clears. Incomplete, and the offensive line had done a superb job of keeping the scrimmage line clean that time. As Gary, we take a look at our Nokia's best connection to this game.
Well, this is the play of the game for Oklahoma. They're down. They hadn't made a first down barely in the second half. It's fourth down, and Jason White comes through against the blitz coverage, throws it out, and Clayton makes the big catch. That's the best connection for Nokia.
133 yards offense for Oklahoma. And 318 for LSU. Bradley is in the game as a wideout. He goes out to the right. Clayton in motion, trying to see what he will draw. There's a penalty flag on this play. The throw is in underneath to Runnels. Runnels picks up first down yardage, but there is a penalty. The linesman threw it on the near side, directly in front of the Oklahoma bench.
And I don't think the referee even knows there's a penalty. He signaled first down.
Well, that play will stand. That's an offside against LSU, and let's take a closer look at Bob Stoops.
My hometown is Youngstown, Ohio. My favorite athlete of all time, Muhammad Ali, because of his fierce competitiveness, his great will to win, and look at the humanitarian he is. Favorite movie, Cool Hand Luke. Favorite food, steak. I don't need to explain that, do I?
You know, folks, we get a very low rating in Youngstown tonight because every time I turned around here in New Orleans, I was meeting a Stoops relative. You know, I think everybody from the town of Youngstown is down here tonight pulling for the Stoops. I'm going to tell that Nick Saban story before the night's over. First down and 10. White starts Clayton in motion through the formation. Jones dashing for daylight to the 28-yard line. And Kewon Jones becoming the running back before Alexander brings him down. All right, Saban was an assistant coach at West Virginia. Youngstown became the team, the town, in his recruiting area. I said, is there any background with the Stoops family? He said, well, I'll tell you the truth, Bobby had already gone to Iowa to play. I knew Mike a little bit. But he said, I would go in, and he had an uncle. Coached over, I believe it was at South High, and he said, we played Jim Rummy down in the boiler room until practice started. He said, I go way back with the Stoops family. Here comes Jones across the 25-yard line, and that's a first down. And Gary, Oklahoma has got it going ever since that interception.
Yes, and also this offensive line, who we've questioned, can they be tough enough? Can they be strong enough to run the ball against this great rush defense from LSU? They're doing it. They're blowing the LSU line off, missed tackles, arm tackles now. It looks like the team that looks gassed right now is LSU, as Oklahoma is able to run the ball, control it with short pass and play action pass.
Ronaldo works, and a timeout called by Oklahoma. 3:41 left in regulation. LSU up by 7.
When Jason White needs some inspiration, guys, all he does is look at a fellow Tuttle native, 28-year-old Brian Stewart. You see, Brian hasn't missed any of Jason's games. Jason and he are very good friends, and Brian suffers from brain cancer. In fact, Jason used to drive him to OU Hoops games. The first person that he called after he won the Heisman Trophy was Brian Stewart. And Brian is here tonight to cheer on Jason White.
Yeah, what a wonderful story and a relationship that those two guys have. Jason said he used him as inspiration. Jack, after he underwent knee surgery in each of those 2 years, he said, look, if my friend can keep going with all those brain surgeries, I can certainly do it. And now it is first down and 10 for Oklahoma. They are inside the 25-yard line. Jones is back in as the running back, and Runnels stays right where he is as the protector. He'll lead Jones to the hole. Beautiful block by Runnels. Runnels, ladies and gentlemen, looks like Matt Snell in that famous Super Bowl in Miami. What a workhorse he has been. He cut the legs off the defender that time to blow that hole open.
Yeah, it was Cameron Vaughn, number 46, right there, who's trying to lead on the fullback. He's ready to muscle up this time. Runnels goes low, cuts him out, and you can see the run.
Quick snap. Jason White comes back, wants to go for the touchdown. Bradley can't get there, into the corner. And he was well covered by Corey Webster. So Oklahoma, on a quick huddle, broke out with that play, took a shot at it. Sign of a confident team. They come back now with third down.
Yeah, Corey Webster knew he had help in the middle of the field, had a free safety there, so he waited to the outside for the post corner move, and that's where the ball was delivered.
Not a good percentage, but the most important third down of the night is this one. They've got it at 5 yards. 3:10 to go. Runnels goes far out to the left side of the formation. White fires on the slant, incomplete to Clayton, and a penalty flag flies at Webster again. If it's against him, it'll be an automatic first down for the Sooners.
Quick slant, got inside. Webster's going to get called for getting his hands on the receiver. Torrey Webster right here. Yeah, had him hands all over him that time. Good call. I don't know if the ball would have been caught, but it's too bad. Got your hands all over the receiver. It's going to get called.
Ball is spotted at the 13-yard line.
Well, this team is showing the heart of Bob Stoops' favorite athlete, Muhammad Ali. They're getting off the mat and finishing this game.
Switch the strength of the formation. Leave Jones in that I-back spot and bring Clayton through it and get him lined up over there in the slot. Play fake and roll toward the slot. Lead pass. Runnels could not pull that one down. And he was being tracked that time by Cameron Vaughn. Fresh respect for Runnels when he slips out of that backfield. Vaughn had decent coverage on him.
Now it's a guessing game. Will LSU bring the blitz? Will Chuck Long dial one of those quick slant passes? Will he go to the fade that Jason White is so good at throwing? Remember, they've even run a quarterback draw down here. Anything to try to get yardage against this tough LSU defense.
They bring Chester in as a tight end blocker. And now the referee wants to have a little bit of a huddle here. The clock jumped back up, so we've had a little bit of a malfunction on the clock during a commercial break, and it suddenly jumped to 10:55.
3 minutes and 2 seconds. Start the clock on the snap.
What happened there is it simply jumped back to where they corrected it the first time, and now it is reset at 3:02. 21-14. Sims. Rashawn, Carter, Joseph, Brown up to the line of scrimmage now for the Sooners. Second down and 10 for Jason White. Back in the gun. Runnels alongside. Clayton will come through the formation. Roll to the right. Throw back to the left and nothing doing.
Boy, great
defense. Not open. Runnels was picked up. He never broke free at all, as the defense, so well disciplined, held its ground.
Yeah, Dave Peterson that time, number 57, stayed home, read his keys, did what that man right there said he was supposed to do. But the quarterback goes away, and there's a back looking at you in the face. Don't chase the quarterback. Gimmick play by Oklahoma, and nothing happened.
Bradley out to the left. Jones and Wilson back on the field after receiving some medical attention. It's four wide. Third down and 10 now for the Sooners. White's under pressure, got a fire high, incomplete as Jones broke open, but White was under enormous pressure. He had no time left. He had to release. He was being blitzed.
You see it right there. They're going to slip the back right down the middle on the all-out blitz. Get it out. Give ground. Just enough to throw it deep, and that could have been a touchdown. Now, fourth and 10 from the 13-yard line, and LSU is going to take a timeout to talk it over.
So Jesse Daniels coming on the blitz that time. Put the heat on White. Well, this has been the end to a great run of sporting events up on ABC, all of the bowl games, the BCS Championship Series, the Rose Bowl won by USC, the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, of course, great victory by the Buckeyes of Ohio State again, then down in the FedEx Orange Bowl, Miami over Florida State, the two wild card games, one of them going to overtime before Tennessee is able to win a toughie on the road. And Carolina eliminates Dallas at home. NBA basketball. And now we come down to the final college football game of the season. And then let the argument begin as to who is the best team. This is ABC Championship Television, and we have certainly had our run here. So LSU huddled up defensively over on the far side. And the Oklahoma defense has seized control here in the fourth quarter. And that allowed them to get right back in this football game. But now you are looking at fourth down and 10 for the Sooners. White checking the sideline one final time. Blitz shows, and here it comes. White steps away, slide step, deflected, incomplete. On the ground, it was close, real close. Clayton on the dive, coming from behind, but the officials were right there on top of it.
Should have been intercepted. The blitz was picked off well by Oklahoma. Nick Saban dialed it. He came after the quarterback. The Oklahoma offensive line did a good job of blocking it up. Ball could have easily been intercepted. It was tipped, though, and Clayton had a shot of it. Got inside, ball is tipped, and it does hit the ground. He double caught it, and the official was right on the call.
For just a moment, as you watch this replay, it is in and out
yep.
of number nine's hands.
Good call.
No
good
question
call
about it. The officials were right there, and now LSU will go to work on the clock. 2:46 to go.
Oklahoma has two timeouts left in the football game. They're going to burn one on first down.
So 2:40 to go, and you know there's been so much controversy about the BCS system. Obviously, we've asked the coaches, including Nick Saban of LSU, about the current BCS system.
We have tremendous respect for the system, and I think we all should have respect for the system that we've kind of agreed to kind of play under. It didn't work very well for everyone this year, and maybe in the future we can make it better so that it will work better and maybe include a few more teams.
You know, I just have one wish, Gary. I wish we had one more game. Just one more game. I'd work for free.
You know, Brent, it seems to me like the coaches involved who have a stake in it have been more reasonable than everybody else about the whole argument.
You know, I would agree with that.
They seem to be able to see the big picture of this thing, that it's hard to measure. The BCS has a tough job. They try to do the best they can under the limitations that they're presented. And this game is a testament to what it can be right here.
And, you know, listen, Pete Carroll handled everything with class.
Absolutely.
Everything with class.
Yep.
You know, the whole controversy being denied an opportunity to come here to the Nokia Sugar Bowl. You know, you couldn't say anything negative about Pete Carroll and the Trojans. And they took care of their business. No question about that. Skylar Green now coming through the formation. Fake by Mauke. He's going to come in behind the right side. And he's to the 19-yard line. Teddy Lehman making the stop for Oklahoma. And we've got another time.
Really like the fact that they ran the ball the first two times and called timeouts the first two times. Both coaches doing their job.
Let's go to the other sideline. Here's what Bob Stoops said about the BCS.
Bottom line is, if you need to be win the conference championship to be in the BCS game, two things need to happen, or maybe one of them. Either we all crown our champions the same way, which would be fine with me, or if we're not going to, make everybody play a championship game. And if that isn't going to work, just tell us before the season starts that you got to win your championship to be in the championship game. You know, any of those would work. Just tell us what the rules are, and we all go play by them.
That's for sure.
Absolutely.
Yep, that's for sure. You know, Nick Saban has been working his defense over there, telling him the game's not over. They made a great defensive stop, but the game's not over. Now, back to Oklahoma's strategy. I like that they used the timeouts on first and second down, because now they've told LSU, do you dare throw the ball on third down? Because if it's incomplete, it will stop the clock. They've almost forced LSU's hand to run the ball on third down.
And here it is coming up, third and four, 2:31. If they can stop him, seal him up inside the 20, force Jones to punt, get Perkins on a fair catch or a decent return, they'll have a couple of minutes to work with. Remember, the clock stops offensively on a first down in the college game. Huge, huge time factor. When you're trying to come from behind to break a tie late. Fake again by Mauke. Complete fumble. Incomplete. The linesman signaling incomplete. I thought for a moment he had control. It was popped out by Derek Strait.
Right. Good defense that time. Oklahoma stayed in the zone. You saw it coming in. The die right there came, caught the ball. I don't know if he got a foot down or not. It all happened in the flash of a second right there. Fake the reverse. A die goes underneath the fake. Watch him come through the screen right here. Ball is lobbed. Well, I could call that either way. I tell you, we could really call that either way. He definitely had the ball. His foot came down. That could have just as easily been Oklahoma's ball.
Benefit of the doubt normally goes to the offense in that situation. We all are aware of that. If there's ever a doubt, and the I think the linesman's getting an earful down. He's pretty close to the Oklahoma bench.
I'll tell you, it was a gutsy call from where he called it, because he's right in the middle of that red when he made that call.
The die, and now he walks back over toward that bench, and there is the young man who made that call. This is Big East crew, and I'll tell you, you can find look for with a couple of small things in this game, but I'm going to tell you, I think this crew has done a heck of a job.
Magnificent job.
A tough, tough football game. Believe me, I believe it. Dye's all right now. The young man from Houston, Texas, are going over.
Look what happened with the incomplete pass.
Now here we come.
Clock hits.
This is one of the great matchups. And LSU, with that great speed, has been able to get down the field on top of Perkins. They have not let Perkins turn loose. Here's number 28. Four punt returns for touchdowns this year. He's trying to stay a little loose back there. Trying to get ready. 2:25. They're down 7 in regulation. The Gunners are covered. Then Bassey moves over now to the left. Let's see if for a moment I thought he was going to try to come. He's creeping back in. Bassey trying to come off the corner, gets picked up. So that gives the Gunner a shot at Perkins, and he tears into him, and there is the penalty. As Shelby gets back on the loose football, but Adrian Mays, number 7, was partially uncovered when Bassey slipped into the formation. That gave him basically a free shot. He was picked up about midway down the field. And then he unloaded on Perkins, and this is such a critical foul coming
up. There is no halo call this year.
But don't you have to give him reasonable distance?
I mean, he caught the ball. He tackled him. I mean, that was a great play, it looked like. On both sides. Look at that. A shove on one of the Gunners on one side of the field, and then a personal foul on the other. There's the shove from behind. Derek Strait catches. There's one penalty right there. There's one. And then let's take a look at the hit. Let's see if he catches it. Oh, that looks like
got
a good
him high.
Good,
how about the hop high with the arm?
Yeah,
there, around
I mean,
the
it couldn't have been
there.
Early. Could not have been a halo call. I mean, he let the guy catch the ball. He made the tackle. He didn't catch his face mask. I think that was a good play.
So Bob Stoops has an explanation now.
There are two penalties on the play. Interference with the opportunity to catch the kick on the kicking team.
Yep.
Illegal block in the back on the receiving team. The penalty's offset. Replay fourth down.
Yeah, the bad thing for LSU now is they almost got that punt blocked, and they have to do it all over again.
Well, you know, we have Dave Perry, who's in the booth. He's the head of the officials in the Big Ten, does a wonderful job, and he's assisted us all season long. Dave, what is the rule with regard to catching a punt in that situation? Well, we'll check on. We'll get Dave here in a second. As we've got it, the other punt.
Let's see if they go return this time. Last time they went block punt. This time they're going return.
Hangs it high, very high. This is a fair catch opportunity. And Perkins has it near midfield.
Look at that. 209, 50-yard line, one touchdown behind with a Heisman Trophy cornerback at the gears.
Yeah, well, unimpeded, Dave has just passed down word to us. Unimpeded is the key word. And so in the official's judgment, he interfered with the opportunity to make the fair catch. There's no standard two-yard rule in that situation, but it was a judgment call. White is back. Press coverage is shown. They set the screen pass, and it's incomplete. As you look down on our scene at the Nokia Sugar Bowl with the BCS National Championship game between Oklahoma and LSU on the line. Second down near midfield for for the Sooners. Four wide receivers. Low and incomplete. Webster, the defender on that side, and it is third down.
I'll tell you, the LSU pass rush that was so strong by the front four before, now watch them when they're out of gas here. Watch these guys rush now. Half speed. That Oklahoma offensive line is able to handle it now, and Jason White should have time.
Well, the police department has come in, and man, there's a couple of my favorite ponies there, huh? They just trotted on over with those officers. They keep the folks down off the field, help police things after this game. Third down and 10. White in the shotgun. Left sideline too high. Threw behind his man that time, and wanted to really stay away. And Daniels has impressed him so much. He had coverage on Peoples, and it comes down to fourth down.
Marquise Hill that time, number 94, the defensive end, got on Jason's feet as he threw the ball. His toes bothering him anyway, and as he stride into this thing, watch, he kind of gets in there, and you can feel it, and just lets that ball go high. One, he could have got there, but he was covered pretty tightly.
There we go now. Fourth down and 10, 7-point game. We got 1:56.
Coming.
Delayed blitz has got him at the 40-yard line. Linebacker Lionel Turner did not come on the snap. They decided to come with the delayed blitz. Jason White thought he had the comfort of a four-man rush. He should know better. Nick Saban in a crucial situation is never going to sit on the four. He's coming with the five or the six. And here came the linebacker right up the gap, and he bore into the quarterback.
Great coverage downfield. You look at this. They've got so many blitzes, Brent. They name them after states, remember? They got so many blitzes. This might be Latvia, for all we know. They ran out of states a long time ago. They got over 50 different blitzes.
I say we should just name that blitz Louisiana.
They used that one in the second game of the year. They're already in the next alphabet.
Yes, sir. It's been 45 years, and now the Tigers and Mauk are going to run out the clock here. And Nick Saban is about to become the highest salaried coach in college football, and Saban is not happy about what's happened. He may think that there's too much for him. He does not want Mauk to back up.
He made
a
mistake.
He's got to just get down on that.
Right.
And that's what the coach is signaling, right, Gary?
Well, I think Nick might be confused with the NFL rule here. Because if you take a sack, the clock stops. In college, I think he's okay doing that. It's still going to run. Maybe Nick's got too much NFL in. There, that's what he wants him to do.
Wraps up on the ground. Just get down. Get down right away.
Now that
if you stay up on your feet in that situation and you back away from the line, the defense has an opportunity to make a play. They could knock the ball away from it. Dave Perry has acknowledged that's absolutely correct. If Mauk takes the snap and just goes down like Saban was signaling him, that ends the play right there, and there is no chance to force a fumble.
Well, unless they fumble the snap, this football game is going to be over.
And Mauk pulling back out almost tripped that time. And we are down to the final 30 seconds. And
well, they're starting it quick. The officials are on it. There's going to be 6 seconds left. LSU will take a delay of game here and figure out what the strategy is.
He's up 7. Even if the clock stops and they take a delay of game, would they send the punter on that deep run through the end zone?
No, you could trip and fall down on this turf. I've seen two guys fall already.
Okay.
You can't do that.
There's the timeout. The fourth down is coming up now. So the Oklahoma side is huddling over here.
Nick is very upset with the official spotting it so quickly. He's upset with his quarterback. He's upset with everybody. They did not want Oklahoma to have another throw. If they take a knee right here, Oklahoma will have one throw into the end zone. Now, Mark Richt caught a lot of grief for trying to run a sweep against Purdue. Remember that? And he said, we didn't want to punt again. LSU could have ran the ball wide a couple times, burned some time, and probably could have killed the game. There's always a way to second guess.
The punter is on the field for LSU. Donnie Jones.
No one's back. I never like putting no one back because the punter can just pooch it over the line real quickly. He doesn't even have to think.
Hangs it. Had an opportunity for Perkins back there at about the 21-yard line. LSU wins the BCS National Championship. Nick Saban coming across the field. Shake hands with Bob Stoops. And let's check in with Jack Aru.
Well, Coach, it doesn't get any closer than this one.
It was exciting. You know, we said in the end, too many penalties. Penalties like that in the early tackling is what really killed us.
Well, better luck next year.
Hey, appreciate it. Had a hell of a game, though, and LSU did a heck of a job. Congratulations, Coach Saban.
Thanks, Coach.
Okay. So Bob Stoops in Oklahoma lose to Nick Saban and LSU 21-14. And our built for tough play of this football game here tonight, the delayed blitz. And coming right up, Lionel Turner from Walker, Louisiana, the junior middle linebacker, puts the cap on an outstanding defensive performance. LSU claims the title.
Welcome back, John Saunders, Terry Bowden, and Craig James. And the reason we're on the field is some of the fans from the Raptors getting a little bit too excited at their first national championship in over four decades, throwing some bottles down here. But you really can't fault them. You wait that long, and what a terrific matchup we saw today.
Yeah, and it came down to 5 minutes and 45 seconds left in the game. The nation's number one scoring offense, Oklahoma, had two shots at the nation's number one scoring defense. And hey, what did we say at the beginning of the game? Defense wins championships.
Yeah, you know what? I thought we saw the Warriors' legs, the Heisman Trophy quarterback's legs, get tired. I think his legs, and he'll admit this in the locker room, were tired. He couldn't move his body around. He made some bad throws down the stretch that during the regular season, Jason White made. LSU got a little tired up front. Gary Danielson pointed that out nicely. But, you know, this just, they couldn't make enough plays down the backstretch.
It is time now for the presentation of the ADT Trophy as champions of the Nokia Sugar Bowl. Let's go to midfield to Lynn Swan.
John Saunders, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been a long time for the LSU Tigers. 1959, Paul Dietl coached a team here in the Sugar Bowl, and they won the national championship. Today, Nick Saban is going to take this baby home. So, before we present it to you, Coach, I'm going to have the president of ADT, Michael Snyder, step up and do the honors.
First, Coach, congratulations on a great season and a fantastic game. Now, on behalf of ADT, it's 21,000 employees, it's 6 million customers, and its parent company, Tyco International, my pleasure to present you the ADT National Championship Trophy for the 2003 college football season.
Players want to handle that trophy.
But championship football games are not supposed to be easy, and this one was not.
It was not easy, but, you know, this team has had such character and showing such resiliency all year to make the plays they needed to make in a game to win the game. I'm so proud of these football players, the seniors, and every player that contributed did a great job in his role. We've got great fans. We've got great people in the state of Louisiana. And I'm just happy that we can make the state proud of something our football team could do.
Coach, your defense, phenomenal. Yep. They put pressure from beginning to end. Is there anything they didn't do that you want them to do in this game tonight?
Well, they did what they had to do to win the game. They only really gave up one scoring drive, and it was on a short field. We got tired at the end of the game, but we played from the heart. All right, we played with our identity, and I love these guys. They're great.
You had a freshman, number 25, Justin Vincent, running your ball. When he broke it open in the first play of the ball game, it had to make you feel good and give you a great deal of confidence to keep running that ball.
Well, it really did. And I was hoping that we would have more consistency running the football. And we didn't really have that as we needed it in the game. It's a tribute to Oklahoma's defense. They've got a great defensive team. Their defense did a great job today as well. But we did what we needed to do on offense. And I think the real turning point of the game was is when they block the punt and score, our offense goes down and scores and counters that. And that was a turning point in the game for us.
Coach, there's some other trophies up here, so I'm going to ask Tim Conrad Meyer, who is president of the Nokia Sugar Bowl committee, to make a presentation.
Yeah, Lynn, I'm very pleased to give you Tim Eckersley, Senior Vice President of Nokia.
Coach Saban, on behalf of all the employees of Nokia, it's my pleasure to present to you the Nokia Sugar Bowl trophy, which this year goes to the national champion, LSU Tigers. Congratulations.
Debate about whether it was USC or whether it was Oklahoma, but there was never any debate that LSU was supposed to be here.
And you know what? I never ever said that, but I always believed it. And I believed in these guys, and they believed in each other, and that's why we're standing up here today.
We also have an MVP trophy to present. Would you like to do the honors again, sir?
No, go ahead.
Okay, I'll do that. There's a freshman around here somewhere by the name of Justin Vincent. Justin, step right up here.
Yeah, baby!
You know, an old coach of mine, John McKay, said he always gave the ball to the running back a lot, said it wasn't heavy. This trophy is a little bit heavier, but you're a freshman, you played like a senior with a passion. Congratulations. Everybody's asking for a speech. Are you a little bit shy about these things, Justin?
You know, before the game, I told the guys, you know, I would give it all back if we could just dominate in this game. I want to do it for these seniors. You know, I've never been surrounded by a great group of guys. You know, when you're surrounded by good people, my coach used to tell me in high school, you do good things. And God dang it, we did a good job.
Now, I'm going to ask you if your quarterback, Mark, is up here. Is Matt up here? Matt, where are you, Matt? Matt's down there somewhere on the field. I wanted to go back, Coach. You didn't pick any team captains during the course of this year. You picked captains for this game. You said you've never had a team that just bought into every individual being a leader ever before in your career.
Well, every guy on this team was responsible for his own self-determination in terms of what he did. And I told him, I said, you know, you don't really need a leader if you can do that yourself. And this is the first team I've ever been associated with that every guy on this team did that.
Okay, now here's your quarterback. Matt, come on over here. Matt, congratulations to you. You are a true quarterback, leading your team, using the assets down the field. Phenomenal receiver like Michael Clayton. You used your running game. When you got behind that center, what were some of the things going through your mind as you faced a very difficult defense?
Well, I tell you what, they did a great job on defense. You know, mixing up the coverages, put a lot of pressure on us. But I tell you what, it seemed like every time we fought that our defense was able to step up, and you know, they really were tremendous tonight.
Congratulations. It has been a long time for LSU.
But Coach Saban, you told me one of the reasons you took this job is because when you were in the National Football League, you looked at where the players came from, and the great state of Louisiana produced five to play, position five or seven, the number of people in the NFL. I think you're going to be in this game a lot in the future.
Well, we've got a lot of good football programs, a lot of good football players in this state, and it's great that they all came together for us at LSU to win the national championship. I'm very proud of this.
Well, Brad.